Good morning and welcome to this morning's meeting. I have, sorry, I'm reading the wrong part of my script. Good morning and welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's 12th meeting of 2021. There are no apologies been received for today's meeting, we're all here. And the first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
We're agreed. Our second item today, we've got two evidence sessions with stakeholders on data and digital services in health and social care. And all our panellists today are joining us remotely. Welcome to the first panel. We've got Scott Held, the Interim Director for Data-Driven Innovation and Head of Profession for Statistics Public Health, from Public Health Scotland, and Ed Humphreyston, the Head of Office for the Office of, for Statistics Regulation. Good morning to you both. I think I'll start things off. My colleagues have got some quite detailed questions, but I guess I want to ask you both what you see as being the key data gaps that currently exist in health and social care in Scotland. And I guess I'll go to Scott Held first.
Thanks very much, Chair, and good morning. So, good question. I think one of the first things to recognise is that Scotland does have good health data. So we have got lots of data which we can use to good effect. And we have the ability to link the data to kind of understand pathways of care. So I think it's really important to recognise that we're building on strong foundations. I think there are a couple of areas in particular that we do need to focus on, and we are focusing on, around social care in particular, and also primary care. So those are two of the big areas that I would say we need to direct our attention. If we can also just bring in from a public health perspective, thinking beyond health and care data. So really, really important that we understand other impacts that lead to poor public health. So things like being able to bring in housing data, education data, and economy data and things like that. So I think really important that we think about the data state in Scotland in its widest sense, not just purely around the kind of data that we collect on health and care.
Scott, can I just pick you up on, I mean, for anybody watching this and wondering why we're focusing on data and what, I mean, it really is a case of having the information in front of you so that actual policy and budgetary decisions can be made. Is that a correct assessment about why this is so important? Oh, we'll just wait to unmute your microphone. If we can unmute Scott Held's microphone.
To individuals. And kind of understanding kind of what's happening in local communities in particular. So a lot of the work we've been doing recently in Public Health Scotland kind of highlights that there are quite big regional differences across the country. So it's not all about kind of one size fits all for the whole country. It's really important that we have that ability to kind of connect in locally and understand what's happening in different parts of the country. So absolutely right that about driving policy, understanding what's happening. But I think it's wider than that, and also thinking about that wider impact on society.
Thank you. And if I can come to Ed Humphreyston to ask if you know where he thinks the data gaps are.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me to give evidence. It's a real pleasure to give evidence before the committee. We've done quite a lot of work with the committee, provided quite a lot of evidence, but this is the first time I've actually given evidence. So thank you very much for the invitation. In terms of gaps in coverage of statistics in Scotland, I'd agree with what Scott has said. For us, the most salient, the most striking gap is the gap around social care. The information available on need, unmet need, outcomes, the kind of characteristics, the demographic characteristics of the recipients of care, it's relatively less well covered than the acute care sector. The acute care sector is very well covered, the social care sector much less so. So for us, that's the most salient gap. It's also worth saying that during the pandemic, I think there was a recognition that data on ethnicity in Scotland and health ethnicity outcomes in healthcare were relatively weaker, and the chief statistician of the Scottish Government, Roger Halliday, acknowledged that in a blog in June of this year, when he said that our data on ethnicity was shown not to be adequate, and at that time he announced a series of measures to create much better data on ethnicity. So those are the two things that I would pick out. If I could just follow up on another thing that you asked, Scott, which was about the need for these gaps to be addressed. I mean, I certainly agree that a bigger picture will help policymakers. That's absolutely right. But I suppose, as the Office for Statistics Regulation, we exist to represent the interests of the wider public in having statistics and data that they can rely on. And I think that what the pandemic has shown us is that there's an enormous public appetite for reliable, trustworthy statistics on health and care and the wider impacts on society of the pandemic. And I think for that reason, we shouldn't just think about these data being useful for policymakers. I think they're useful for citizens as well.
Thank you very much. That's really helpful. I'm going to move on to my colleague, Sue Webber.
Yes, thanks, convener. Yes, Mr. Humphreys, you mentioned there about some of the salient gaps you said in social care being the unmet needs, outcomes and demographics. So if they are the gaps, how could we start capturing that data?
Well, we produced a report on this in February of last year. And one of the things that we highlighted, of course, that this requires quite a significant degree of investment in analytical resource, that the kinds of people that Scott has working for him, who are able to take data and integrate it, analyse it, produce insights from it. But also, of course, underneath that, the data themselves being accessible, being linked, being available in electronic form. I think the good news is on both of those, there is real progress. I mean, Scott will be much better placed than me to talk about the progress. But one thing that I'd like to pick out, which I think has moved things forward, is the use of a database called Source, which is created by Public Health Scotland to collect social care data. And that's produced an output called Insights into Social Care. And I see that Insights into Social Care as the start of the process of filling these gaps that I've outlined. There's a lot more to do. If you look at that Insights into Social Care report itself, Public Health Scotland are very honest about the gaps, the quality issues that they face, but I think it shows the pathway to improvement. But as I say, Scott may well want to follow up on that, seeing as he's responsible for those outputs.
We'll bring in Scott.
Yeah, thanks very much, Ed. Just to follow up then, do you recognise, so Source is a data collection that allows us to capture data on people who are receiving care at home at individual level. So one of the benefits in Scotland is by having that individual level data, we're able to link it across different data streams. So as Ed highlights, kind of making those connections between social care and the health service, our Insights to Social Care report did a bit of work about understanding kind of what happens to people once they enter into the social care system. So I think just to pick up on a couple of points that Ed made there. So Source is a great step forward. I think one of the challenges with Source is that it's a data collection which comes in quarterly from local authorities, and we effectively use it to produce the annual report that Ed talks about. So it's one of the areas that we're looking at in Public Health Scotland is about bringing in the data more quickly. And I think for a lot of the things that we have so far published and analysed, kind of data at that kind of annual level is adequate. It kind of tells the story of what's happening across care at home in Scotland. But in terms of data being a bit more real time, helping inform what's actually happening right now, there are improvements that we recognise we need to make there. So that's one area. I think the other area Ed touched on was analytical resource. So just to highlight there that, you know, relative to the amount of resource we have going into kind of health data state, the amount of resource going into social care is considerably smaller by quite considerable magnitudes. But that's something that we're currently actively looking at in Public Health Scotland. And I think it's coming back to a point that Ed made around kind of outcomes and really understanding kind of why are we collecting this data, what good is it doing, and is it having the impact that we need it to have. I think just to highlight to the committee that one of the big things for Public Health Scotland, and we mentioned this in our data and digital strategy, is that we do need to do a review of all the different data flows that we've currently got and the outputs that we currently do. Because in order to kind of make the shift into looking at particularly areas like social care, we do have to think about doing things differently and doing different things. So I think that's a really, really important piece of work that we're doing. The other really important area is that there's also an analytical team in Scottish Government who also collect data and report on social care. And one of the things that we've done recently is we are more actively engaged with that team so that we're effectively pulling the power of the analytical capacity we've got in this area, particularly to make sure we're not duplicating efforts so that we're doing things once. And that's really, really important for the local authorities who submit data to us. And I think if I could just highlight on that at the moment as well, I think one of the challenges we have is not so much just the capacity nationally to manage the data and analyse it, is also the capacity locally to actually collect it and submit it to us. So I think there's been a real lack of investment for various reasons in the kind of data and kind of data collection estate in local government, and that does need to be addressed. And I think there are real opportunities now with the National Care Service on the horizon, and we're certainly pushing in Public Health Scotland for the legislation to feature heavily requirements around data at the heart of all of that. And I guess building on the legacy of the health data that we've got from ISD, which moved into Public Health Scotland, which, as you know, is well established, I think something equivalent at the heart of the National Care Service is going to be fundamental to how we tackle this. The other final point, if I may, is also about partnership. Public Health Scotland can't do this alone. And we are talking to COSLA, one of our joint sponsors. So again, having that joint sponsorship between local and national government will help. And we're also talking to the local government digital office, who I know are giving evidence later about how we can connect it with what they're doing to improve the flows of data. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much. That's very helpful, because you spoke about one of the challenges being that local collection, I suppose, and then due to the lack of investment specifically with local authorities. So do you think there's been enough work being undertaken to understand those issues? Yes, investment's a big thing in terms of that money, but what else is the hurdle and the other gaps that might be existing in terms of that data collection that creates the variance?
Yeah, I think what I would say is that's work we're continuing to do. So it's work in progress. Mm-hmm. And as I mentioned, we are working with COSLA and the Local Government Digital Office to understand that. So I think what's really key is understanding the current data landscape. So it is a bit fragmented. There are data collections into Public Health Scotland. There's data that comes into the care inspectorate. There's data that comes into Scottish Government. So understanding the totality of what comes in, and then reviewing it, because we need to make sure we're not duplicating effort. Mm-hmm. And we also importantly need to understand the gaps. And I think the other really important point is about having data at individual level to allow us to link it to the other data, because to allow us to understand outcomes and to understand what happens to people, that ability to follow people through the system is going to be really important. The other kind of issue I would say that needs to be looked at more, and we have made progress on that, particularly during COVID, is the whole aspect of information governance and data sharing, particularly around social care data. So we have that well established for the health service. There's a well established processes and pathways around how we deal with information governance. It is more complicated involving local government, and that's certainly one of the areas with Public Health Scotland having that dual accountability that I wanted to make sure we're doing more work on that space to make data sharing as straightforward as possible. At the moment, it can be quite a paper chase to get the appropriate sign-offs to allow the data to flow and to allow the data to link.
Thanks. Okay. Bring in Emma for a supplementary.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you both. I'm interested in the issue about duplication of effort and wondering about the capacity, which Sue Webber talked about as well, the capacity to obtain certain data. And during the pandemic, there's obviously been more data gathered. Has there been any pause to some data collection? Because in some of the work that I've been doing, people are a bit fed up of data collecting and feeling like all they're doing is hamsters on a wheel gathering data, but what's the data for? So I'm wondering if there some data has been paused in collection, and also whether you think that there needs to be more work done so that people on the ground know what the data is being gathered for, and then what are we going to do with it?
You make a really good point there. So in terms of data that's stopped, so most of the national data sets that Public Health Scotland have responsibilities, so mainly around health and care and the source data set that Ed talked about, have continued. Most of these are fed from electronic, what we call management information systems that can manage the health service, so those systems still exist, so the data can still flow. I totally understand what you're saying, though, about kind of data collection fatigue, because you know there have been additional asks around COVID, and one of the challenges is actually making that connection between the people who are responsible for collecting and managing the data locally, and understanding ultimately how it's used. And that is an area I would say that we do need to do more work and kind of build that narrative with the people who are collecting the data. And one of the reasons why that's really important is that the people who are collecting the data, by them understanding why it's been used, can then measure or make sure that the quality of what's then submitted is as good as it can be. So no to data sets being stopped, but absolutely recognise that there's been more data collected as a result of COVID, and we need to do that narrative around helping people understand what the data has been collected for at source.
Can I bring in Sandesh Gohani? Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. I have a number of questions based around ethnicity. And I know, Ed Humphreys, you've mentioned ethnicity in your first answer, but I just want to focus in on this. How can we ensure that we get good ethnicity data? And I'm not just talking about patients, I'm talking about workforce as well.
Thank you. Well, a number of these questions, I think probably you'll get a fuller and a more complete answer from Scott. I think one of the key things, though, to say about ethnicity data is one of the best sources of ethnicity data in Scotland is, of course, the census, self-completed by individuals to identify their ethnicity. And I think one of the important steps that the Chief Statistician, Roger Halliday, outlined when he addressed this problem this summer was to say to make greater use of linking census records into other data sets, like the healthcare data sets, but also the school census and others. So I think this is an area where, actually, in a way, to go back to the last question, the answer may not be necessarily in launching lots of new data collections, which have the risks that we've just heard about in terms of burdens on data providers, but more in using the power of data linkage to draw on the data that we do have, and then to populate the other data sets with the attributes, the characteristics, which are recorded, particularly in the census. That would be my sort of high level answer. Scott may want to embellish that and provide some more specifics.
We'll come to Scott.
Yeah, thanks, Ed. That's exactly the approach that's been taken. I guess it's been tackled from two fronts. So one is there are some data collections that do collect ethnicity. One of the challenges, though, is that the ethnicity data is often poorly recorded. So either people don't want to, for personal reasons, to disclose it, so we don't know. or some of the categorisation isn't as good as it could be. So we have got ethnicity data on some of the data collections, that the main one being our hospital discharge record does collect ethnicity, but it's not of the best quality. And one of the areas that we've been looking at is, as Ed says, kind of thinking through how we link other data sets that also collect ethnicity, like the census, to understand how we can triangulate between the different data sets. Now, one of the other areas that I think is important that we look at, and I'm not close to this work, but I could certainly find out more about it for the committee, is around the kind of development of the CHIS, the Community Health Index in Scotland, which is obviously the unique number that we all have that features in all our health records. So having a way to add the ethnicity details to the CHI would go a long way, because in effect, that's the central spine that populates a lot of the personal details around a lot of our personal data. I think there's an opportunity with the kind of revisions that are happening at the moment around the CHI, think about how we bring in some of these characteristics that we don't currently collect data on. But it is recognised as a challenge. And we have, within Public Health Scotland, been able to publish data looking at the effect, particularly in COVID, on different ethnic groups. So things like the testing and vaccination, there is work that would be published publicly on ethnicity, but I would agree that more needs to be done on that.
Sandesh.
Thank you. Certainly, Scott, talking about how data is poorly collected, NHS Lothian, for example, went from 3% to 90% in ethnicity over 3 years. And that linkage to the CHI number goes back to a point that Emma Harper just made about data fatigue, where if we ask ethnicity on multiple occasions, if it's answered just once and it's linked to your CHI and that CHI goes through everything, surely that would be the way that we would ensure that all ethnicity is captured in that way. And so I have a question sort of around, once we capture ethnicity data, are we absolutely sure that we could then use that data to work out symptoms and how you present, work out how we should be managing you, and work out how we can treat patients using that data? Like with high blood pressure, where if you're of Black descent, you shouldn't be started on an ACE, you've started on a calcium channel block. So it makes a huge difference, that ethnicity, to the way that we can treat people.
I would completely agree with you. I think that there's two aspects to your question. So one is around, if I've understood it right, is around data, yes, for direct patient care. So data that's held in systems that allows you, when you're having the conversation face-to-face as a GP with a patient, that you understand the ethnic group and what that might mean for the individual. I think from the perspective I was talking about was around the kind of nationally available data that we have within Public Health Scotland. So I am absolutely confident if we can reliably capture data on ethnicity, then we can analyse it, and we can analyse it in many, many ways. And we've shown we can do that through the work we've done around ethnicity in COVID. I think one of the things we need to keep an eye on, though, is data quality. So really, really key that when we start getting the data, that we kind of understand the patterns. Is it making sense? And the old mantra of use improving quality will definitely be key there. I think one of the key things, though, is you're absolutely right about if we could collect it once and connect it to other data, you know, we should definitely be looking at that. And I think the CHI is the route. But at the moment, it's not collected through CHI. So that's definitely something that we would need to look at. And then we would need to consider kind of how do you populate the CHI, because you know many of us have a CHI generated when we go to the GP. We'd have to think about potential data gaps initially about how we would address that. So this has all been looked at, as Ed said, through a group being led by the Chief Statistician at the Scottish Government. But I definitely think that approach of having this collected once that then feeds other data sets will be key going forward.
Before I come to Sue Webber, who wants to talk about the integration of data, there's something that occurs to me when I'm listening to you both, is around the patient's rights about where their data goes. Is that one of the barriers to this? I mean, if you're given your, particularly, you're given your data, you want to know where it's going, what it's been, coming back to what Emma's saying, what it's been used for. Is that sort of data security and that knowledge of the individual as to what their data's been used for, is that an issue? I don't know who wants to come in. That's just a very short thought that I've had, Scott.
Maybe come in on that. So I'm not aware of that being a major issue, but I think one of the key things that's highlighted in our data and digital strategy, and Edge has highlighted it in the work that OSR have been doing, around maintaining the public trust about kind of what happens with the data and how it's used. So I would say in Scotland, we've got a proven track record through the work that bodies like Public Health Scotland do in managing data safely and securely. And we've got mechanisms and processes for making sure that that happens and that access is only given for appropriate reasons. I think it partly comes back to the question that one of your colleagues made earlier about the actual data collectors and helping them understand why the data is important. And I think we need to do more on the narrative around that. But we could also likewise be doing a lot more in our conversation with the Scottish people about why we use their data, why it's important, and all the safeguards we have in place to keep it safe. So I think that's definitely something we need to think about taking forward as well.
Thank you. Right. Did Ed Humphreyson want to come in?
Yeah, I just would like to come in on that very quickly. Two points. One is I completely agree with Scott that Scotland is well placed. It's got a very good approach to the engagement with the public around the public acceptability of their data being shared. And I think in some ways Scotland has got a better platform for this, and actually does Wales, Northern Ireland, than England does. That's the first point. I think there is a strong base. I think the second point though is that it's really key to go back to where I began my very first comment, was that we should always remember that data and statistics are not simply for central decision makers, but they are also to inform the citizens about what's happening in their community and in their country. And I think the more that can be remembered as being the purpose of this data collection, it's not simply to inform a few commissioners at the centre of the system, but to inform the whole population, then the population will appreciate that their data are being aggregated with other people's data to create these rich pictures. I think always coming back to that purpose is really important here. Thank you.
Thank you. Right, in terms of integration of that data, Sue Webber.
Thanks, Convener. I suppose you spoke about that rich picture there, Ed, but I suppose when it comes down to individuals, you know, what we often have to do is translate it into what that means to them, for them to understand, and that comes down to whether or not you're the patient or if you're the data inputter, the healthcare professional that's run ragged with nothing, 100 balls in the air, and is being asked to type in some stuff. So what can you do for those two groups, both the patient and that healthcare professional, what that means to them? Can we translate maybe by giving a specific example, if that's possible?
Ed Humphreyson?
Yeah, I suppose we can do a couple of things. Firstly, lots of the improvements that we've outlined as the Office for Statistics Regulation build on there being easily accessible, portable electronic records. Now, for the individual, obviously that has huge benefits for the aggregation of statistics to give this aggregate picture that I've been talking about. For the individual, of course, that has benefits in that they won't need to feel a need to repeat the same information to repeat it in repeated different healthcare settings. And it's clear, for example, from the Feely review and from the Scottish Government's digital healthcare strategy, that this issue of people being frustrated by having to repeat their own personal circumstances and their personal health history is a frustration. So I think they can see a benefit there. And on the professionals, I think obviously they benefit from that too, because they will have information on which to provide better care and better professional judgment. But I also think that the ability to know that the situation that you're dealing with in an individual case is part of a broader societal pattern is really, I think, is really powerful. So knowing how the specific relates to the general, which I think is what statistics are for, they help you understand how an individual situation is part of a bigger pattern. So those are the two points I bring out in answer to that question.
I'm not sure if Scott wants to say anything on that. Sorry, convener, taking over from you there.
Scott.
Sorry, Gillian.
I'll just unmute Scott.
I was just trying to get off mute there. Yeah. No, I agree with everything that Ed said there. I mean, I think another point that we need to consider is the kind of IT infrastructure across the country and the kind of digital estate we've got. And colleagues who are speaking in the next session will be better placed to speak about that than me. But obviously, a lot of the data that we are kind of managing and collecting and analysing in Public Health Scotland is a product of things that happen locally using local IT systems. And one of the challenges is that they don't all join up. They certainly don't join up between social care and the health service. And I think one of the big, challenges or ambitions for us should be have more of that join up so that you can enter the data once, as it were, and it's available for all the different pathways of care. But I think we do need to recognise that there is a kind of digital IT part to this that also needs to be tackled.
Sue? Yeah, thanks, convener. So that comes on nicely then to this next one. How are the frontline staff and those that are involved in the data input being involved in deciding what data should be produced and how? Because obviously you're really wanting that data to go in accurately to start with, which will then stop lots of problems going down the line. So that quality aspect is really key. So that's my question there.
I can take that one first. So that's absolutely crucial. And I think maybe if I can take that in two parts. One of the aspects is, as I say, we've got a good health data state already with well-established data flows that come in automatically from particularly the hospital systems. So there's lots of data we capture and use through that process. And one of the key things then is about kind of working with local teams, local clinicians, local nurses, patient groups to kind of help them understand kind of what the data is saying for their local area. And sometimes it's not until you actually do the analysis and pull it together and enable those comparisons between a particular local area and say the rest of the health board or the rest of Scotland, that starts generating questions about why there's difference. And sometimes that difference can be down to how things are recorded. And you can then have that dialogue. The other side of it is data that's newer, and so stuff that's maybe not as well established. And certainly at the heart of any new kind of data conversations, as it were, the users and the people who will be collecting the data are fundamental to those conversations. And just as a couple of current examples, we, as I mentioned, are doing work through the local government digital office in COSLA around social care data. So there is a local government data leads group now, which Public Health Scotland will become a member of, and we're keen to be kind of talking to those data producers, as it were, to help them understand the power of what we can do if we pull the data together in a consistent manner. And then the other side of it is just thinking of some of the work we've been doing recently on cancer. So we've been on a big modernisation journey around our cancer data, hugely important at the moment. And we've tackled that with kind of clinical groups and patients through having a series of roadshows around the country. So having presence, for example, in the Western, in Edinburgh, so people can talk to us about the data that we are collecting or planning to collect so they understand how it's been used. And that's been great because that's facilitated really good conversations with clinicians about how they intend to use the data that we are collecting and producing. So I think just as somebody, there's two aspects to that. One is about new data. Really important we have the users and the providers in the conversation at the start. And for well-established data sets, it's really important that we continue to have the conversations that people understand what the data is looking like and what it's telling them.
Okay, thank you. We're going to look at primary care data and questions from Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to our panel. You know, primary care is obviously very much in focus at the moment, particularly in the context of the pandemic. But I think it's fair to say that over you know, many years, there's been commentary that data hasn't always been good or available enough, I think, in terms of primary care and understanding you know, who is using primary care, where the trends are, and those sorts of areas. So I wonder if perhaps, just as an overview at this stage, if the panel could outline, you know, what information on primary care activity and demand is publicly available at this stage?
So I can begin that one, and Ed might want to come in on this. So this is an area I identified that is still a challenge. So there, I think the short answer is that there's not much data published on primary care. However, we are taking steps to address that, and we are now collecting data. We've now got 700 practices submitting data to Public Health Scotland on disease prevalence. So a lot of the focus on the data that we collect at the moment in Public Health Scotland is on the kind of clinical side of primary care, so understanding why people are going to the GP and kind of what the patterns are looking like across Scotland. So that's less on the kind of workload data, I would say, around kind of who's turning up and what the volumes are. So definitely improved data, and we are looking at kind of now about how we publish that into the public domain so that people understand kind of the disease prevalence across the community from that primary care data. And we are currently working with colleagues in NHS National Services Scotland around capturing data on what I would class more of the kind of activity data about people who turned up, appointments, etc. In primary care. And we hope to have, or plan to have, a data set in place over the next month or so on that. And then obviously next steps around that would be looking at the data quality and understanding it to enable that to be published in due course. So that's, I would say, making big strides forward compared to where we've been. The other thing I would just highlight around GP data, just to kind of explain why it's so tricky. At the moment, the GP data essentially is held in each of the practices individually. So we've got, in effect, 900 plus instances of data stored. And at the moment, there's no straightforward way of extracting all of that. Although, as I say, we have got the mechanism in place now to bring in data from the 700 practices who are participating. However, we have learned a lot from the COVID pandemic. There has been quite considerable GP data brought in, particularly around vaccinations at pace, and the work we're doing with NSS around more of the activity data is based on the work around those data flows. The other key thing is that the GPs themselves, or the practices, are the data controllers, so it's really important that we maintain trust with them about how their data has been collected and used. Data is often at what we call aggregate, so kind of very anonymous level. That still allows us to do a lot with it. But one of the challenges of that is that you're not able to link those data to other data. So further work we're doing is looking at how we can bring in individual level data that would require further conversations with the GP community and in particular the patients. And then just finally on the horizon, something called GP IT reprovisioning, so kind of upgrading all of the GP IT systems. And my understanding of that is that the way that the data is kind of stored and managed will be very different. It will be much more cloud-based from what I understand. And the advantages that brings is that organisations like Public Health Scotland, with the appropriate permissions, we'll be able to access the data a lot more straightforwardly than the current situation where we have to go to 900 practices individually. So there's quite a lot in there around the background to primary care data. We are now making progress around the disease prevalence and looking at kind of activity data, and there is opportunities on the horizon with the GPITV provisioning. Thank you.
Thank you for that very comprehensive answer. I suppose the question for me, following on from that, is probably twofold. You know, one, how do we sort of use that data that we're hoping to bring on stream to sort of chart somebody's journey through health and social care? So you may present to your GP, but then obviously you may go elsewhere, or you know, you may feel that A&E is an appropriate presentation for you, but there's obviously a discussion at the moment about where presentations have been made. So how do we perhaps link and look at someone's journey, but also I think how do we chart almost unmet needs, so where people aren't having their needs met in the most appropriate place, particularly in digital, you know, a lot of people using digital more and more. So how do we chart that?
Yeah. So I guess, you know, that comes back to the points I was making about that ability to link data in Scotland. And in order for us to link the data in Scotland, that relies on the data being at an individual level. So I think we need to have other conversations around primary care in particular, around the individual level data, because to allow that kind of pathway analysis about where do people go, what are the pathways of care, kind of who starts in primary care and ends up in hospital, etc. We do need to do more work on that. One of the things I would say is, though, that there are effectively other data sets and proxies that can be used for some of this. So we do have good prescribing data, for example, in Scotland, and the prescribing data is at individual level, and we do link that to the hospital records. So what you can do then is, for particular conditions, understanding the prescriptions that go with that. That's one way of understanding kind of what the pathways of care look like. But I also think it's about taking steps in the right direction. So being able to have the aggregate data, understanding disease prevalence, for example, in the community will be hugely important. That would help us understand the difference between what it looks like prevalence in the community versus people who present at hospital. The hospital data itself, you know, does record kind of what the path into the hospital was. So if it was a referral from a GP, we know that, and we know the practice, or whether it was through A&E. And some of the work that Ed mentioned that we've done in our Insights from Social Care report is doing exactly that, looking at those pathways. How did people end up in hospital, and what was the path to get there? But also, really importantly, what's the pathway after hospital? Where do people end up going? So definitely more to do with primary care data, but there are things we can do with the existing data we've got to answer some of these questions that I think you're posing.
Ed Humphreyson.
Yeah, thank you. Just to supplement that, I think this issue about availability of primary care statistics and data has been quite long-standing. If you look back at Audit Scotland reports on the NHS in Scotland, over the last 5 or so years at least, probably going back further, they have highlighted that there's very good data about the acute part of the NHS, the acute hospital sector, but more limited data on primary care. And actually, we wrote to this committee, its predecessor, in August 2019, again, and highlighting actually the very point we were just discussing about the difficulty of charting journeys through primary care and community care into the hospital system. I think I'd just say a couple of things. Firstly, I completely agree with Scott's analysis that actually thinking about community prevalence of disease is an important place to start, because that starts to get you to the kind of the population health, not what's happening through the system. And I think that's a very, very important thing to understand. I think the second point is, I mentioned earlier, I made some very positive remarks about the Insights into Social Care report. And Scott, in fact, has just referred to some of the insights that report has on primary care. But I think I would say that there isn't such a clearly obvious equivalent yet in the primary care sector, which pulls together a range of information. And I think that's really the thing that we'd really encourage Public Health Scotland to do, is to do an insights into primary care output, maybe something along those lines. I think that'd be enormously helpful to start to paint this picture of the primary care landscape. Thank you.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Just a quick question. If we're talking about patient journeys, so that we, or a person's journey throughout the whole system, quick question is, will the clinical portal support that if everyone had access to the clinical portal as far as journeys? And I'm thinking also about social prescribing. So when we're referring people to men's sheds or third sector, for instance, would that be something that could be part of any data processing as well?
So I'll be honest here, this is an area I'm not as familiar with in terms of how the clinical portal works from a kind of digital and data perspective. I think colleagues who are joining the next session would know more about that. But certainly, from the way you described it, it certainly sounds like the type of approach that would be helpful to avoid what we talked about earlier about the kind of multiple instances of adding in the same data about the same people. So apologies, I don't have the detail on that, but I think it could be followed up in the session following this.
Okay, we will do. Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Convener. Everything we've spoken about here is fantastic when it comes to GP and the data that GPs hold and having it across everyone and everyone being fully integrated. But at the moment, the GP system doesn't talk to itself. So Vision and EMIS do not talk to each other. There is no data integration between the two. I'm sort of straddling the two themes here. What can we do in the immediacy to allow GPs to access data from simply another GP data source?
Again, I think that's probably a question that would be well directed to the digital colleagues who are joining later. I think what I would say from a kind of data and statistics perspective, exactly what you've described is part of the challenge that we've got with the kind of current setup in primary care and kind of being able to access the data. And you're right, Vision and EMIS not being able to talk to each other. And I'm not familiar with the exact details of all of this, but even with those two suppliers, there can be different ways that it's installed in different practices as well. So it's not even necessarily as simple as solving it for a Vision and EMIS talking to each other. I think it's more about how do we facilitate that kind of safe and easy transfer of data across practices, full stop. But again, it's not an area I'm familiar with, and I think talking to digital colleagues in the next session, they should be able to give more clarity on that.
Okay. Thank you. And my second question, I'll be brief. At the moment, you've said that there are 900 different data holders, so it's about the Caldecott Guardian. And so the GP is responsible for that data. If we move the data onto a cloud, if we allow lots of other people to access it, and we are going the way that we want to, who is responsible for that data? And surely it can no longer be the GP.
Yeah, so that's a good question. Again, digital colleagues may have a view on that in the next session. And the important thing, though, will be about how the data is stored and how it's accessed. So my understanding around that will be that practices will still control the data that's their data, so they will still be data controllers. I think the important conversation that needs to take place is around kind of how do we build on the good infrastructure we've already got around things like the Public Benefit and Privacy Panel, which considers access to the wider suite of data and being able to link it. And then, for example, when data becomes available in Public Health Scotland, so if we receive data from practices, the current process is very clear that Public Health Scotland then becomes the data controller for the data that we then hold, and we are responsible for maintaining the safety and security of it. So I don't think it's as nuanced as practices not continuing to be data controllers. That will still be the case. But again, colleagues who are joining us in the next session will be more familiar with exactly how the approach is planned to work.
Thank you. We're going to move on to talk about social care data, and Stephanie Callaghan has questions on that. Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener. Sorry, talking about primary care there then, you know, we're talking about the challenge really, I think, of pulling together that data and that information to use it effectively. But when we start looking at social care, we're in a whole different situation there where we've got really, really big gaps, if you like, too. I mean, certainly I think it's helpful, you mentioned earlier on about trust and confidence of the public, which I think actually going through COVID, people are appreciating more the importance of data and getting access to that there as well there. And for quite a long time, our GPs have been incentivised, if you like, to record core data in a kind of standardised way. And I'm wondering what you think about the NCS, how that could perhaps assist with bringing that through for social care, something similar. Thanks.
Who would like to go first on that, Scott?
I don't mind starting on that. So I mentioned that I think that there are opportunities with the National Care Service, and I think the key thing would be about making sure that data is at the heart of the legislation that comes with it. So I think the fact that we've got really strong health data is largely down to the kind of legacy of how that was all set up through kind of ISD as it was before it joined Public Health Scotland over those years. So we've got the kind of learning and the legacy from how we've handled health data. And I think we need to carry that forward into the National Care Service. And I think then it's about understanding the data needs and asks. So the conversations we've been having about talking to people about understanding what data is available, what data might we need to be able to answer the questions. So being really clear on the questions we're trying to answer to determine the data we need rather than the other way around, I think will be really important. I'm not so sure about what you were alluding to around the incentivising. I think what's really important in the setup to the National Care Service is that whilst recognising that data is important, is also recognising then that we make sure that we fund appropriately the kind of data and IT infrastructures that have to come with that. So I think we would definitely miss a trick if that wasn't in at the outset of the National Care Service. And really, really importantly, that we work across the country to get those common definition standards, understand what the questions are across the country, so we're doing things in a consistent way from the get-go, rather than currently where at times we have to grapple with the fact that the 32 local authorities do things in a slightly different way.
And did Ed Humphreyson want to come in on that? Ed?
Yes, just to supplement that, I think the National Care Service has obviously a huge amount of potential for transformation. And I think there are some things within the kind of architecture of the National Care Service which will help with the issues we've been talking about this morning. Not simply the focus on data and an individual's data being more complete, but I think actually the emphasis in certainly in the Feely review on engagement, engaging with the public and engaging with the individual, actually I think that sort of creates a much better platform for ensuring that data are used to answer the questions that people are interested in. I think that's really powerful. If there's one thing that I would encourage that those responsible for designing the NCS to give a bit more thought to, it's something actually that you as a committee raised in February 21 when you published a report on the future of adult social care, and you made lots of the points that we've covered today, but you made an additional point which I thought was really important. You said that more needs to be done to educate and inform the wider public about adult social care and to challenge people's assumptions. And I think the point that as a committee you were making was that there's actually, aside from the moment of crisis, when people in a crisis mode need to engage with social care, either for themselves or for a family member, there's not a broader understanding of what social care offers, how to access it, the choices that are available. And I think the point that you made very well as a committee is that actually there is a job to be done of informing and educating the public. And I think it'd be really nice to build that into the National Care Service design, as well as all of the good things we've talked about already today.
That's great. Thank you very much there. I think as well, I did mention the fact that GPs are incentivised, but I think really it's about recording that core data in a standardised way is probably the really, really important part of that. And I'm wondering, what can we actually learn from perhaps other countries about the minimum data sets for social care that's helpful?
So I could maybe come in on that one. I think one of the things to say is about Scotland is actually we're often ahead of the game. So I think it's really important that we do learn from other countries. But as Ed mentioned, we have got what we call the source data set, which is actually a data collection about social care, already exists. And we went through quite an extensive period of consultation with local government, with various groups, third sector, etc., about the data we would need to capture to answer the key questions that were being answered. So it's not that we don't have data already on social care, we do. We've got that to build on. I think the challenge I highlighted at the start is the kind of frequency of how that's collected and how it's done is not high, so it's quarterly. It's quite an ordeal for the local areas to kind of collect and submit it. So I think we've probably got a really solid foundation already about what the data are that we need to be collecting. I think there's further work needed on the kind of underpinning IT and digital to kind of harmonise that if we can across the country, making sure we've got those common definitions and standards, as you said. And then kind of using the source data set we've currently got as a kind of platform to think about kind of where are the gaps and what do we need to further add in. So I think you're absolutely right, we do need to understand what other countries are doing. But I think just sometimes taking a step back and recognising that Scotland's actually well placed to do this. And because of, I guess, because of having a body like Public Health Scotland and our custodian of the kind of national health and care data, there are a few other countries that have that ability to link it to the other data sets to provide that more nuanced understanding of what happens to individuals as they flow through the system. So I'm actually quite optimistic, but without the investment, though, in the underpinning digital and data in local government, I think this will continue to be a challenge.
Can I bring in Ed Humphreyson on this before I go to supplementary questions on this?
Thank you. I think the first thing to say about social care statistics and data is that this is a challenge everywhere in the UK, Scotland, Wales, England and Northern Ireland. So the issues that we've talked about today arise everywhere. And I think in some ways there is a very good platform in Scotland based on the source database. And I think also something we haven't mentioned, but the survey analysis of carers, which has identified the extent of unpaid care in Scotland. I'm not aware of such a kind of comprehensive piece of analysis being done elsewhere in the UK. It may exist, but I don't think I've seen it. So I think there's some really strong foundations there. Having said that, there are things to learn from other parts of the UK as well. This is the one of the benefits of having in us as Office for Statistics Regulation, being able to look across the UK and identify areas of learning and so on. So two areas. One is, I think, the primary care. We were talking earlier about primary care. I think the primary care picture, I think there is much richer data in England on primary care. And in terms of linkage, the place to look, the sort of the top of the league table, I'd say, would be Wales. They have an incredible resource called the SAIL Data Bank, which is, I think, market leading in terms of safe linking of individual data and then making that accessible in a safe way to both government and to researchers. So, I think there are things to learn from other places.
Thank you. And can I bring in Evelyn Tweed?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. It's really good to hear Scott say that he's very optimistic about social care data and to see that maybe Scotland could lead the way in looking at social care data. Obviously, from the evidence, it seems that social care data just now is quite poor. It's not integrated really with the healthcare system. Do you feel we have enough leadership to take this forward and to really be world leaders here?
So I think the answer to that is yes. I guess that this feels a bit odd, but I guess I'm one of those leaders then in this space. And I think with Public Health Scotland and the role I've got within Public Health Scotland and that dual accountability we now have as a body to local and national government, I think we're well placed definitely to lead the conversations around this and make progress. And there are other colleagues that I know are joining you in the next session from Local Government Digital Office, so that there's great leadership there too. And we are actively talking to them at the moment about how we work together essentially to make this happen. So I think we are, I guess, a unique stepping point here. And I think the decision taken about Public Health Scotland at the start to have that dual accountability will begin to pay dividends as we go forward through that really strong connection we'll now have with working with local government.
Would Ed Humphreyson like to come in?
Absolutely. I think in terms of leadership, I think I'd say the potential is there for some really significant changes and improvements in social care data. In fact, one of the reasons I say that, and I can't believe it's 1 minute past 10 before I even mention this, but we've just gone through a pandemic where the statistical system in Scotland has shown that it can work collaboratively in an agile way, it can produce things at enormous speed, it can actually get access to shared data in a way that probably wouldn't have been seen possible beforehand. The amazing things, remarkable things have been done. And I think building on that leadership, which made all of that possible in the pandemic, means that we have the potential here to really drive further change. Of course, we as the regulator will be watching this keenly. We want to see it happen. We want the potential to be realised. But I think the potential is there.
Thank you. Can I bring in Paul O'Kane?
Thank you, Convener. I think just follow up on the point about how local government, I think, has worked across the piece to try and drill down into people's experience and perhaps the services that they require. I was quite interested in Professor Bruce Guthrie at the University of Edinburgh's work and recommendations in this area, but particularly the idea that we can use NHS data around kind of unique addresses to link in people, to understand people, whether they're living in sheltered housing or whether they're in a care at home scenario or whether they're in a care home. I'm just keen to understand, how do we ensure in the National Care Service that we're still getting that quality of localised data and information about a person? And that helps us perhaps to see the bigger picture in terms of housing mix, housing need, requirements in an individual area, whether that's rural or urban, and those sorts of issues.
Could we go to Scott Held first?
Yeah, thank you. No, I think that's a really good point. So I know Bruce Guthrie well. Bruce and I worked together on a number of areas, particularly during COVID. I'm well cited on the work that he does. And I think Scotland is well placed to do what you've described. And there's something, and I have to confess, I can't remember what it stands for, but there's something called the UPRN, which is all about that kind of thing that you're talking about understanding people's addresses, where they are, and all the characteristics that go with that. And that's a bit like the kind of CHI number, in a sense that it's unique to an address or unique to where somebody's staying. So the power of being able to kind of analyse and use that is really important. And probably linking back to the conversation about leadership. So I think recognising that there are, or leadership can come from many different sectors. So Bruce, for example, and the work he does, he's a kind of well-respected in the academic sector, and we work really closely with the academic sector in a lot of work, particularly around some of the challenges with social care data. So I think it's about making sure those voices are also heard, and that we learn from that, and that we make sure we build this into, as I was saying, kind of what is the underlying data infrastructure that will go with the National Care Service.
And did Ed Humphreyson like to come in on that?
No.
No, thank you. Can we move on to talking about workforce data with Gillian Mackay?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. What would the panel consider to be the biggest gaps currently in our workforce data?
I'm happy to take either of you. If you want to go to Ed Humphreyson first of all.
Actually, can I suggest we go to Scott first? I'm probably not as knowledgeable about this.
Thank you, Scott.
Thank you. So, this is an interesting one. So, maybe just to highlight where responsibility for workforce data and statistics lies. So, that's the responsibility of NHS Education Scotland. So, colleagues from NES will be kind of well placed to talk about the data gaps more than perhaps I will be. I was involved in workforce data years ago, but not as close to it now. And I know colleagues from NES are joining the session next, so I think they would be able to answer that more fully. I think what I would say is that we've got certainly readily available. We've got strong data on the NHS workforce. I think looking at other sectors like social care, less so, and certainly from the perspective of what I'm cited on within Public Health Scotland. But I have to confess that workforce data is not something that I'm hugely close to at the moment because of that responsibility now lying with NHS Education.
So, Gillian, I don't know whether you want to save your questions for the next session then. Right, we'll move on then. That makes sense. We're talking about data sharing and common data standards. And back to Sue.
Oh, thank you, convener. Sorry, I was checking that was on. You obviously said earlier, Ed, about how we were very agile and we moved at pace during the pandemic in terms of our data. And I was interested, one specific example draws to my mind, and I was wondering how it manifested. NHS Lothian were very reticent to accept the browser Chrome on any of their systems, and that was a massive hurdle in the utilisation of their patients and the NHS Attend Anywhere platform, and now it seems to be... So I'm just wondering how you got around that at the point of the pandemic when, as a, as I probably state, as a councillor in the City of Edinburgh, I had a motion at the IGB at the time to get them to move onto that system. So I'm just looking for a bit of... What was it that was the final trigger to get them to move over?
I don't know if anyone wants to come in on that.
I have absolutely no insight into the decision making would be. But what I would imagine that these things get kind of caught up in, you know, different people's responsibilities. Somebody's responsibility for security, another for IT procurement, and nothing much happens until you get an external pressure, which is sufficiently great to kind of shift everybody into a kind of more activity. And I imagine that's what's happened here, is that eventually people talk about a burning platform. It's a bit of a cliche, but maybe it's the time when the cliche is really relevant, that the platform was there, that finally meant that it had to be done. But I'm afraid I don't know a great deal about NHS Lothian's decision making, so I am speculating, and apologies to them if that's not what happened.
And maybe a question directly for the NHS Lothian rather than our panellists today.
So in terms of sticking on that theme, has the innovation that you've been using in terms of statistics, I can't say it, data collection, during the pandemic allowed a more or less risk-averse attitude to gathering data by both public and the healthcare professionals, I suppose?
And is that directed at Scott?
Either, I suppose, whoever might be best placed.
Ed, you look like you want to answer that.
So I'll give a quick answer, and then Scott, who's been close to this in Scotland, will be able to kind of supplement it. I think yes, I think there has been a shift. I think one of the things which we haven't talked about much today is the development in very fast time of daily dashboards, and you know, daily dashboards. Obviously very useful for decision makers, for ministers, for officials at the centre of government and in health boards. But actually, what we've discovered is that by making information available on a daily basis, there's a huge public appetite I think something of the order of 20 million visits to the Public Health Scotland dashboard, something like that. I'm sure Scott will correct me if I've not got that quite right. So I think that not only has the experience of the pandemic unblocked some of the things, and we were just talking about the browser issue, maybe as an example of that. I think there are examples around data sharing, very much so about bringing data together more quickly. But I think also in the presentation of data, in creating dashboards that are really responsive to public interest. So, and I think those innovations can stick. I think they can outlast the pandemic. But Scott, you may want to supplement Scott. That.
Yeah. And so I hesitate to correct the stats regulator on a figure, but I'll do that if I may, Ed. It's 45 million hits now on the Public Health Scotland dashboard, which is quite phenomenal. So, I think the whole pandemic has brought about huge innovation in how we work. We've highlighted it in the Public Health Scotland data and digital strategy. About we need to kind of build on this, and we mustn't go back to old ways of working. We must learn from how we worked in the pandemic. And our daily dashboard, just the phenomenal reach and use that's had to help people understand in particular, you know, what's happening in their local areas around COVID. It's still getting lots of use each day at the moment. But I think what's hidden from view is actually the kind of work in the background to actually pull all that together every day. There are kind of thousands and thousands of data items that kind of feed into that every day. And what we've done is something that I know that the stats regulator have been kind of encouraging stats producers to think about, is something called what we call the reproducible analytical pipeline. So this is about, as far as possible, how you can automate end to end so that actually the manual intervention is as limited as it can be. And essentially, the processes that we've got behind the production of the daily COVID numbers, our daily dashboard, I hesitate to say it's push button because it's not quite push button, but it's as automated as it can be so that we are confident that each day we can produce the figures that are required. And that whole legacy of automation, investing in the time it takes to actually automate it in the first place to get the gain further down the line, is a message that we're taking further into Public Health Scotland. One of the reasons why it's so important is if you can automate, you eliminate human error. So that's critical. So that improves the quality of what we do. But also it reduces our ask on our analytical workforce from doing what I'm going to call, I don't mean this unkindly, but some of the more routine for them, pretty boring, pulling together the numbers every day, to doing much more of the value add about kind of what is this data actually telling us and what does it mean for Scotland. So a real legacy, certainly for me in my area in Public Health Scotland, is about building on that. So we're doing much more automation. I'd like to see much more use of dashboards. So I think I can say this, you know, the historic way that we've produced our official statistics with lots of PDFs and Excel tables and things like that is old-fashioned. The huge engagement we've had with the dashboard shows that if you present it in a good way, people will engage with it and act on it. And so the current things we're thinking through just now is what is the kind of public health equivalent of our daily dashboard for the future that will get that engagement with the country. And it'll be really important to talk to people about that. We also recognise that COVID is hopefully once in a 100 years type event, huge focus for everybody. Everybody's thinking about COVID. Everybody wants to understand it in the local area. That will drive people to our COVID dashboard. And how do we kind of build that kind of momentum around all the other stuff that we do so that we're adding that value? It's back to the point I was making earlier about reviewing what we do and how we do it so that we can make sure that we're adding the value and release capacity to do more about some of the stuff we've been talking about around areas where there's gaps like social care and primary care. And while I've got the floor about COVID, it would be remiss of me not to mention the huge power of work all our staff in Public Health Scotland, but obviously across the system, have done in kind of maintaining this level of output and scrutiny over the last 18 months. I've never known anything like it in my career. But what is great is there are real lessons we can learn about how we do things going forward. Thank you.
There's a number of colleagues who want to, you know, come drill down into the lessons of COVID, but can I bring in Ed Humphreyson before I go to Emma Harper?
Yeah, two things. One is I'm very happy to be fact-checked in real time by the Head of Professional for Statistics of Public Health Scotland. So sorry for getting my numbers wrong there, and thank you for the correction. But a bit more seriously, just to say we, as the regulator, really support the line of thinking that Public Health Scotland is developing around how to develop dashboards which are accessible to the public on a wider range of topics. I think that really is a promising future.
Thank you. Emma.
Thanks, Convener. The information that we have available to the public, I think, is fabulous. I've been using the Public Health Scotland dashboards myself in order to better inform me. I'm interested in how, so what can we do then to support the health literacy of people digitally? Because it's something that if we're going to encourage people to, you know, not only take better care of themselves outside of a pandemic, but how do we support then the development of a more health conscious public?
Scott?
Sorry, I'm battling with the mute button there. No, that's a really good question. And I think that that's kind of part of our thinking and our challenge around kind of what the future of how we present our statistics and data about all aspects of health and public health to kind of help people understand what it's telling them. But I think that point about kind of health literacy and people understanding what it means for them is really important. And it's probably, it would be remiss of me not to highlight that obviously within Public Health Scotland, we do a lot more than the kind of data and stats that I have responsibility for. So that question about kind of how we're messaging key public health messages so that they land with people, I think is really important. And then how we kind of get that, I guess, buy-in from people, that people understand what that means and what it means for them. And I think it is a challenge. I think one of the things about COVID is it impacts on everybody. So everybody's affected by COVID. Everybody wants to understand what's happening in their local area. Everybody wants to know what they can and can't do. I think it's more challenging when it's particular health conditions that are more unique to different parts or segments of the population. But it's absolutely the heart of what we also want to do. And thinking as well about digitally, are there tools we can develop that can help people get that kind of health literacy that you talked about? So I think I would say that's work in progress, but definitely something that's on in the forefront of our minds.
Ed Humphreyson, want to come in on that?
Yeah, very, very briefly. I don't have a lot of thoughts about health literacy. It's not a specific topic I've given much thought to. I'm very often asked about statistical literacy. People say, well, is an issue with the public value of statistics bound up with challenges with the statistical literacy of the population? And I'll say what the answer I give to those questions, because I think it may be pertinent to health literacy as well. The answer I give is I'm always a bit reluctant to just say, oh, yes, there's a problem with the general population's statistical literacy. Because I think if you say that, you're sort of implying there's some kind of deficit of knowledge or of capability in the population. And I think that I'm not sort of ready to sort of sweepingly dismiss the kind of capability of the population as quickly as that. I think a better way of thinking about this is that people often have quite good understanding of things which relate directly to them. And they can be quite sophisticated in understanding those things. And the trick for professionals is to communicate things in a way that latch onto and land with those understandings that members of the public have. And I think it may also be, that may be a way of thinking about health literacy, not sort of thinking about it in terms of there being a deficit in public understanding and knowledge, but more how to translate professional knowledge into insights that the public can engage with more easily.
Scott wanted to come back in, Emma. Scott? Bring in Scott. Scott, you wanted to come back in, Scott?
Yes, please. Thank you. No, it was just to build on what Ed said. Completely agree. I think Ed put it much more eloquently than I did. And I think one of the challenges that we need to be mindful of about things like dashboards. So our COVID daily dashboard is great. It's loads of traction. But the kind of nature of the speed of how it's produced, how the data goes out, that there's not much narrative that goes with it to help people understand what is all this data actually telling us about the state of the pandemic. And that's why we've got the complimentary Public Health Scotland weekly report, which tends to do that, kind of walk people through kind of what are the different aspects of the data telling us about the pandemic. So it's really, really important that we kind of think about how we do that going forward, particularly with the pandemic, kind of understanding the patterns and trends, I would say is of much more interest now than the daily numbers, which are fluctuating depending on the day of the week. And so I think Ed's point there about kind of how we then, as the kind of statistical community, help people understand kind of what all this is meaning is going to be crucially important going forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Emma, you have a short question and then I can move on.
Sure, I'm happy to move on. I think it's a really good point to not imply a deficit in knowledge. I think we do need to look at the positives, and because the public, because of the pandemic, are probably very, very educated now about clinical vulnerabilities and things like that. So I'm just, I guess, what learning will we take forward from what has been initiated in data collection during the pandemic, and how will we take that forward?
Is that directed at Scott?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think as I said, kind of the very nature of the ways of working within an organisation like Public Health Scotland, more automation, doing things at pace, all that will continue post-pandemic. And then I think back to your point about, you know, the fact that we have developed products now which have really, really engaged the public. People are using them. We need to build on that going beyond the pandemic. Thank you.
And as we're coming to our last 8 minutes, Carolyn Walken, you had some questions about Public Health Scotland's digital strategy, just to round this off.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Good morning. Yeah, I was interested just to hear a wee bit about your view on the digital strategy, and you've quite clearly stated that you look at the strategy in terms of both data and sort of wider digital, you call it IT solutions, and if you think that that is the best way of moving that forward. And just in the interest of time, the second point I'm interested in is just that you acknowledge the sort of difference between your strategic level thinking in Public Health Scotland, and then locally it tends to be more sort of driven by a business as usual, rather than what initiatives and what changes we can make for public health in general in their areas and across Scotland. So I was just interested in how we can try and move that area forward.
Thank you, Carol.
Yeah, Scott. Thank you. I totally recognise and agree with all that you've said there. And I think what's important is that a body like Public Health Scotland has set the vision about kind of how data and digital can be used to improve public health. We obviously as a body have been set up with that ask of addressing some of the public health challenges that Scotland faces. And the reason why it's a data and digital strategy in essence is that the two have to go hand in hand. You know, usually data feeds from a digital or an IT solution. So it's really, really important that we kind of crack both hand in hand. And that's why, as I say, our work with, for example, the Local Government Digital Office is going to be really, really, really key. And I think the point you made about often what's happening on the ground is driven by today's needs, not future needs. And I think that comes back to the points that were raised around leadership and about how we're engaging with the people who provide the data. I think also wider in kind of other roles within local government in particular, also having that understanding, they can kind of then cascade through their organisations. And I think it still comes back down to, we can talk about kind of the best data in the world, all this great digital stuff, but if we don't get the investment right, and with this amazing opportunity we've got with the National Care Service to have the data and digital work at the heart of it, we'll have really missed a trick. So I would really, really encourage that in thinking about the legislation for the future of National Care Service, that we make sure data and digital is at the heart of it so that we can do a lot of this ambition that we're laying out here. Thank you.
Carol, okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. No, that's great. Thanks very much.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. I don't know if there's anything that either of you would like to add that you maybe haven't had the chance to say about the system. We have got our other panel, of course, and thank you very much for setting up, I suppose, those more detailed areas that we can go into with our... But just give you the chance if there's anything else you wanted to... Ed Humphreyson?
Yeah, thank you very much. Just a final point, which is maybe something I should have said right at the beginning, actually. The essence of what we do at the Office for Statistics Regulation is make sure that the public can have confidence in statistics produced by government. And a lot of that obviously is to do with gaps, and it's to do with quality and all of the things that we've talked about. But I think another really, really important aspect of it is what we call trustworthiness. In other words, that the public can be confident that the statistics emerge from a professional analytical process. They're not just the subject of what policymakers want to tell the world. They're not a sort of they're not the product of communications effort, they're the product of professional statistical effort. And really, we're here more than anything else to preserve that. I just think that's so important. I think that the lessons learned review that we produced highlighted how in Scotland, Public Health Scotland has played that role, and Scott's leadership has been really important in preserving that professional independence. But it is really important, should never be taken for granted, and of course we continue to be a regulator who takes it very seriously and is vigilant about it. I just thought that it would be remiss for me to leave this session without making that point. It's the real foundation on which everything else is built.
Thank you very much.
And thank you very much for the time to ask me the questions.
Thank you very much. And that is a good note to end on in terms of public trust. Thank you to you both for your time this morning. It's been very interesting, very helpful. We're going to suspend for 10 minutes or so to allow our next panel to onboard and for us to have a wee break. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I now welcome our second panel on data and digital services in health and social care. And we have a number of experts in front of us remotely. Before I introduce you all, I'm just a bit of meeting management. With us all being here and our panellists all being remote, what would be very helpful is that if our MSPs maybe try and direct their questions to individuals, but those individuals, if you want to come in, if you've not actually been asked to give, but you have something to add, if you could use the chat function on the BlueJeans app, the platform that you're on just now, I will see that and I will try and bring you in. If that's helpful. So we have Martin Wallace, the Chief Digital Officer for Local Government Digital Office, Christopher Roth, the Director of NIST Technology, Jim Miller, the Chief Executive of NHS 24, Shalona Shute, the Chief Technology Officer of the Digital Health and Care Institute, Chris Mackey, the Digital Hub and ALICE Programme Manager for the Health and Social Care Alliance, and Dr. Steve Bagley, the Clinical Director for eHealth of NHS Grampian and Chair of the Clinical eHealth Leads in Scotland. Welcome to you all and thank you for giving us your time this morning. I guess that the first thing that that I would like to ask you all, I mean, I'm actually going to do a round robin of the six of you in contradiction to what I've just said, but just to allow you all to talk about your support or otherwise of the three aims of the Scottish Government's refreshed digital health and care strategy, and whether you believe that there is alignment and support for that in the institutions that you represent. So if I maybe just go first of all down that list again and go to Martin Wallace first of all. Martin.
Good morning and thank you for giving me up as a witness. I do support the kind of three main ambitions of the new refreshed digital health and care strategy. I think behind the scenes we've got some great learnings from how we responded to COVID. We've got great learnings from the original digital health and care strategy of 2018. And from the previous panel as well, I do agree with a lot of what Scott Hield has said about data standards, interoperability, and principles, which is going to be the kind of the core components that we're going to have to do and create and implement if we're actually going to make it come to life.
Thank you. And can I come to Christopher Roth?
Good morning, and thank you also for inviting me along this morning. Yes, I wholly support and agree with the aims of the Digital Health and Care Strategy. And again, I think they are entirely sensible in the context of if you were going to look at a forward-looking, citizen-centric approach to the way that we want to deliver health and care in Scotland, then that is the strategy that you would devise. I don't think the strategy is, if you like, the issue here. I think the challenge is the complexity of the existing landscape that we are working in order to be able to do the sort of level of transformation that's required in order to achieve the strategic outcomes. It is a challenge, but it is an achievable objective. And I do think that just to support what Martin's just said, the COVID-19 pandemic, one of the good things that's come out of it is the absolute commitment that everybody involved in delivery of this strategy has to working together to make it happen. We've proven that not only is the technology that we are adopting the right technology, but the approaches that we have now worked through and are developing are the ones that are going to take us to where we go. So while it's still a bit of an uphill struggle, I think that we need to be optimistic about where we are and where we're going.
Thank you. So the desire is there, but the challenge is accepted has been quite a tough one for everyone, Christopher.
Because the desire and the need of everybody involved to ensure the services that are currently being delivered can be maintained, are safe and are able to keep up and keep pace with the demand. We would go faster if we were to building on a greenfield, but we're not. So we have to find the right balance between citizen safety and care and the ability to transform services. And that's where the challenge is. But, you know, I can say with confidence that the colleagues that I'm working with across the entire enterprise of health and care have shown the necessary skills, capability and leadership to get it done.
Thank you. Can I come to Jim Miller from NHS 24?
Thanks and good morning, everyone. I would wholeheartedly agree with the colleagues that have came before in terms of support for the strategy. Probably add two things. I think one is that I think the strategy has the balance between ambition and choice, so that it's not an either or for citizens and users. So therefore, that idea of inclusion and equality, it runs through the strategy. I think the second point, and we may well discuss it more throughout the session, is the attitude of the public and acceptance of the public using the pandemic as an accelerator potentially of how services are transmitted and indeed how services are consumed, I think has changed. And therefore, I think we find ourselves in a position where that ambition is matched both by internal capacity, but indeed a desire amongst the people of Scotland.
Thank you. And can I come to Shalona Shute from the Digital Health and Care Institute?
Thanks for having me on. So we're very supportive of the three aims from the Digital Health and Care strategy. I'd echo everything that the others have said around recent capacity building that we've had around COVID. Looking specifically at the aims, aim two and three, predominantly about how professionals, be they health and care staff, or planners, researchers and innovators can use data and data-driven approaches to drive service transformation. And that's great, and we support that, obviously. The thing that's most exciting for us as an innovation centre is that aim one is now strengthened, which is to say that citizens will have access to, but also greater control over their own health and care data. And from the previous session around the Public Health Scotland and the statistics piece, we showed the value of creating that dialogue and giving citizens a more active role, giving them access to and the ability to manipulate data. And so if you think about that in the terms of someone living with multiple sclerosis or on a cancer care pathway, similarly, if we can start to co-manage the care data with them, professionals know a lot, but the citizens also know a lot, and they're the ones who understand their lived experience, and they have the drumbeat day-to-day lived experience that can help inform more predictive and more personalised care models. So it's really heartening to see that kind of co-management of data with citizens is starting to come through in the strategy.
Thank you. And can I come to Chris Mackey, please?
Hi there. Good morning. Thanks for inviting me along. Yes, I think that from the Health and Social Care Alliance perspective, we would be supportive of the digital health and care strategy. I suppose the devil's in the detail. You know, when we come to implementation, when we come to see the delivery plan, I think that's where we'll see some of the detail exposed around the ambitions that the strategy presents. A few points that I would make would be that it is a digital health and social care strategy, so not to forget the social care aspect. And the bit about people living good lives. Building on the comment about equalities, I would go further and like to see the full realisation of human rights approaches, and that allows us to look at not just the protected equalities characteristics, but looking at carers, looking at poverty, looking at migration, looking at care experience people, for example, who need to have their rights upheld. We've done quite a bit of work around human rights approaches and principles within digital health and care, and I'll just run through those briefly. People at the centre, so starting with the person, not starting with the shiny digital tools. Using digital where it's best suited, it's not always the best solution. Digital is an ongoing choice, so people can opt in or opt out of digital. Digital inclusion, not just widening access. So that's about having the skills, not just the device and the data connection, but the skills to operate that. And it's also a workforce point about skills development within the health and social care workforce that we need to address. And finally, as has already been said, citizens having access and control of their data. And that's come through quite strongly from the engagement that we've done with people who are sick of retelling their stories, and they would like to see more effective sharing of data between professionals. But they would like to retain that control, and they would like to be reassured about the security and the confidentiality aspects. So those are some of the main points that I would highlight in respect of the strategy.
Thank you. And can I come to Dr. Bagley?
Hello, yes. So I think the aims are certainly ones I would support, and I think it's great to see the focus on citizen access to data and services. That's absolutely what we need. Under aim two about the basing services on a person-centred approach, I'd be keen to draw out the benefits there for staff in terms of removing low-value admin tasks, for example, from clinicians in particular. And I'm keen to see how, as we develop the delivery plan, how we connect the strategy to those levers of delivery in those hundreds of locations all across the country.
Thank you very much. I'm going to hand over to my colleague Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, convener. My question is perhaps directed to Martin Wallace, maybe Christopher Roth, but definitely to Martin. And it's about AIM 3, which is about allowing healthcare researchers and innovators secure access to data. So my question is, how can we give companies and innovators access to anonymised data to improve services that they can provide? And also, how do we then get a significant benefit from giving them access to our data?
Thank you for a great question. I think it has to come down to, I'm going to go back to the earlier committee with Scott. We need to have data standards and principles established. In the Digital Office, we have a data community we've set up in local government. We've been working with people that create data in local government for a while now to look at operational standards and data standards to try and get things more aligned to ease that process through. But otherwise, we do pay quite a lot of money out to get integration, which is just crazy these days and age. We should have open standards for a lot of it, but cyber secure at the same time. I think that you would also maybe want to speak to Chal at DHI, because DHI have already done this kind of work already in aggregated anonymized data for test purposes. So there is a balance between taking data, informing the patient, stroke customer, stroke citizen about what we're doing with the data and how we're putting safeguards and measures in place to aggregate it, to anonymize it, so we can do research for all intents and purposes to find new ways of services.
Sandesh, did you want to address somebody else?
If Christopher wanted to come in on that or not.
Christopher Roth?
Yes, thank you. So unsurprisingly, I'm going to support everything that Martin has just said, but I think also one of the keys here is the technology that we're currently now building and deploying in order to make it meaningful in real time for people to be able to make the kind of decisions that they need. We need to have the technology based on data standards that are going to allow people to access the data when they need to. That's one of the fundamentals that we need to get to, that we need to liberate the data from being trapped inside systems and only being accessible after a whole series of processes, whether they're technical processes or whether they're IG processes. We have to get them to a place where people can access them on demand in order to be able to drive real value, because things are moving very quickly now, and people's expectations are that that kind of process, that kind of business, that kind of service is available to people on demand. So they want it when they want it, and we can't predict when that is. So we need to build technology that allows us to do it. And we now have that technology. We are in the process of deploying it. So if you combine the technology with the standards, then you're going in the direction in which we need to go.
And Shalona Shute wanted to come in as well on this.
Hi, yeah, thanks for bringing me in. Yeah, absolutely agree with everything that's been said. I guess you'll probably hear this a lot in this session, the need to separate the data from products and systems so that we have more independence in how we can use it flexibly in a consented way. I guess for me, it's just worth noting we have data safe havens set up in the north, east and west of Scotland, where people can already go as researchers and innovators to access those anonymized data sets. Still in the early stages, but starting to gear up now. So that kind of thing is starting to happen already, under strict governance and kind of ethical processes. I guess one last little point would be, when people usually have these conversations about how we access that anonymized data set to drive innovation, typically in people's heads they go straight to the idea that the clinical record is the place that we need to be focusing that effort and getting that right. The reality though is, if we're trying to predict and personalize services, then the clinical record is only one part of the story. People may have their own activities, daily living data. They might have their own smartphones and devices and smart home technologies, and we might have social care data, social security data. So if you want to drive real prevention, you can't just look at the clinical record data, because the NHS records are, the record of disease in the main, whereas other systems may have the clues that give us the ability to anticipate issues and act in that more direct, preventative way, with the citizen consenting, of course.
And Chris Mackey would like to come in.
Yes, it was just a very quick point around interoperability and these different sort of almost fragmented systems talking to each other. And I manage the ALICE programme at the Alliance, and the ALICE programme is built on open standards. So when it comes to working with other platforms, the use of open standards makes that process much more straightforward. And those open standards are largely out there. That's the point about openness. But I think I would make a plea to move towards that if new systems are being developed to use open referral standards or whatever it is, so that it just makes the whole process much more straightforward.
Thank you. And we have a number of questions on the National Digital Platform and data sharing in particular. And we'll come to Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Could we have an update on the development of the National Digital Platform and a flavour of what work is currently ongoing on it? And that's probably Christopher Roth, maybe?
Just
go in there. Yes, so where we're at with the National Digital Platform. So what we've realised through the pandemic is that the National Digital Platform can't be one thing. It has to be a collaboration and a collection of pieces of technology, information and data that is spread across the enterprise of health and care in Scotland. That's one of the lessons that we've learned very clearly. And what that means is that in the specific details around the National Digital Platform, the vaccination programme, the mass vaccination programme for Scotland, has driven an enormous amount of data availability into the technology that we were already deploying in the context of a build site for the National Digital Platform. We now have some in the region of 10 million records and increasing every day, which is relevant to somewhere in the region of 4.5 to 5 million individuals in Scotland. So we now have the baseline platform in space, and we've also started to build the necessary catalogue around the services that are going to be required in order to support it. I think the next stage is a more collaborative and active dynamic with both the health boards, but also with our colleagues, social care, across all the different aspects of that, from local government through to the private sector, third sector, all of those aspects on what it is that we need to build next, which is going to drive maximum value in the earlier space. Because when you think about the ambition of the National Digital Platform, which is to have all the data pertaining to an individual's care, whether that's health or social care, in a single logical space available to all the different aspects of individuals working with those citizens, and primarily the citizens themselves, that's a big ask. So we've got to be able to figure out how we can drive the platform to deliver maximum benefit against the backdrop of a remobilisation for the NHS and for social care restructuring around the National Care Service. So the answer to the question is, where we're at is, we've got somewhere in the region of about 10 million records in the platform now. We've got a connection to our CHI services, which is going to be fundamental to linking the data. We're putting together a catalogue of services that we can provide to our social care and health sectors, but we are now, more importantly, in a dynamic conversation about what's the next stages around the delivery, because we need to make sure that with the finite resources available that are both there to support services that are currently in place and the ones that we need to bring forward in order to be able to build the platform, we need to get the balance right. And that's what we're working through at the moment, with a view to having a delivery plan ready for the early part of the next financial year, which is one that everybody can recognise as being the best way forward. So it's a moment of time where we're taking a breather to say, right, we've put the platform in place, we've got the technology there, but now we need to make sure that we build it out as fast as possible to deliver for maximum. And at the centre of all of that will be delivery to the citizen, which I figure I'll sort of explain a little bit later on in different questions.
Thank you for that. What work is and should be undertaken to ensure that information sharing can take place between the wider primary care team and multidisciplinary team, the acute sector and social care, to make sure that we have all the records in the right place at the right time? And what problems have there been in joining all those records up? And that's probably Christopher again.
Christopher? Sorry, is that me again?
Yes.
You broke up a little there. Yes. Okay. So I think that the problems we've already touched on, and I think we're going to continue to unfortunately reiterate some of the same answers, which is at the moment there is an enormous disparate firmament of systems that we have to try to draw together. So there is no logical single record for a citizen in Scotland in health and care. There just simply isn't. And that's for good reason. I mean, the way that systems have been developed to support the services, whether it's primary care, whether it's in the acute sector, whether it's in social care, individual organisations, groups of people delivering services to citizens have had to independently build their technologies in a way that has not always been about interoperability, but it's about being delivering the services that those people want. Now, what we know now is that with the right connector, which is going to be CHI at this point in time, obviously the sophistications around personal identification may spread out as we try to become more pan-public sector. But within the context of health and care, CHI is fundamental to the success of all of this, because as long as we are now in a position where we can both standardise the data structures that we need inside the systems that exist already, and then bring all the data into a single place, will be fine. In terms of the barriers to success, I don't think that the barriers now are organisational or even to a certain extent IG, although we do have significant information governance challenges to get through. The problems really are now coming down to the technology itself. We have to move ourselves away from the technologies that have been really very good at supporting the type of services that we wanted to deliver. I mean, the technologies that exist out there inside our health boards, and to a certain extent, I mean, I'm not overly cited on social care, but the technologies have been really, really good and very fit for purpose and have been supported and delivered with excellence. The issue here is that they are very much designed to support process. They're very much designed to support the capture of data and information to target specific outcomes in specific organizational settings. What they're not designed to do is to provide services to the citizen, and we have to do that transformation. So the barriers to that are being able to deploy the technologies that we know are going to succeed in that, while at the same time not disrupting those services. So I think that we are on the cusp of being in the place where we want to be, but we've still got some challenges around delivering the technology while not disrupting services, because we have a finite number of people that we can actually deploy to make this work. And they're all fairly tired at the moment, and they're all pretty stretched and trying to remobilise services both in health and care. I hope that answers the question.
And Dr. Steve Bagley wanted to come in from his perspective. Dr. Bagley?
Yeah, I think in terms of all staff connecting to that data, I think it's important to bear in mind the national organisations versus the health boards and the role that health boards have in delivering these views. And that then it comes down to the different capacity that different health boards have in terms of resourcing, what priorities they have, the IG capacity to deal with these sort of novel information flows. And those aspects start to come in. So I think that's how, I guess, you get to that issue around the strategy connecting to delivery on the ground and how we make that connection really firm in order to get the benefits of all elements of the strategy, including that central data spine.
And Martin Wallace wanted to come in.
One of the points. I think we also interpret information governance and data governance in completely different ways, depending on which council we're at, which health board we're working for, and then central services. We really need to tackle that in an ethical and secure way, with also having data literacy being sort of promoted back to the citizen, so the citizen understands fully what's happening to their health and care data records, how we're actually going to use that health and data record to help with better outcomes, give them the opportunity to actually, you know, get in through the front door, which is obviously in the health and care refresh strategy, to get access to the health records to make more informed choices on how they actually want to be looked after or what care and services they actually wish to take. So I think that there's a kind of element in there which has kind of slowed down things at times. And the other thing as well is not just about, you know, access to digital health and care records, it's actually about collaboration between multifunction teams, as you mentioned as part of the question. So, you know, we are doing work with Microsoft Teams that was rolled out across health and care back at the pandemic at great speed, but also how do we create common platforms, which means that we're not having to retrain or use different systems to access different health records, etc. We're using common platforms to get the right data at the right time to make the right decisions. Therefore, we can actually increase the health and well-being of citizens in Scotland.
Gillian? Okay. Sue, you have some questions on this area?
Sorry, Gavina, theme three? No,
we are still on the data sharing and the NDP.
Okay, the data sharing then, thanks, sorry. I suppose it's great to hear of the work that's being done, but the reason we called this today was because we had a sense that there was a whole lot of groups that were raising concerns that there wasn't the data there for decisions to be made. So I suppose maybe to Mr. Miller from the NHS 24 element, in terms of, because that's almost the public face of the data, can maybe help. How can we help with that disconnectivity about everything that's going on and the impression from all those third sectors and our other people that have spoken to us about the concerns about that data?
Jim Miller.
Thank you. Yes, a very good question. I think in some respects, NHS 24 is, as an organisation, is almost a recipient of the ambitions of the strategy, and indeed faces the challenges that have been discussed in the last few moments. Where I think organisations, national organisations like 24 have a place is almost the manifestation of this idea of the front door. So we talk about the front door, and I think we need to be careful that that's well understood by the public and by users of our services. From a NHS 24 perspective, we have the opportunity to, because we engage with so many, so we have close on 40,000 calls a week, we are able to supplement the engagement with those members of the public with the supportive documentation in terms of why do you ask those questions, what do you do with my information, who is it shared with. So we can use our digital and online resources really to act as that, obviously, a kind of trusted point of truth around how organisations within health and care use it. Now, clearly, there will be differences between the way NHS 24 shares its services and other parts of the health and care service. I do think it has an advantage as a national organisation to be able to provide the answers to those questions that citizens increasingly are asking.
Sue?
Thank you, Convener. I suppose this one's to, I'm just checking, in terms of the NES, so that's to Mr. Roth. How do you look to collaborate with other stakeholders and organisations? Because you've spoken about that collaborative and active approach, and Dr. Bogley mentioned that we needed a strategy to really deliver on the ground. So what are we doing tangibly to do that?
Christopher Roth.
Yeah, thank you. So there are a number of governance bodies that I am directly engaging with, the Enabling Technology Board, which is part of the Strategic Portfolio Delivery Board for Digital Health and Care. But well, I'm actually active in the process of directly engaging with organisations. My calendar is fairly full with individuals who have recognised that the significance of role that I'm privileged enough to be playing in this work. And I am directly engaging with organisations both at executive level, and my teams are engaging with individuals working. And that is about painting the picture and getting the overarching view as to what's important and what's significant to organisations. And these are organisations in the third sector. These are local authorities. These are IJBs. These are obviously, I have extensive network of communications in and around our health boards. So it is an active process where people, and it's really encouraging as well, because people are coming directly to me as the person with the responsibility for coordinating this role. So it's not as if it's not understood where to go in order to be able to work with this. But I think it's also very important to state again that the governance bodies are very important in the context of being able to create the necessary landscape for prioritization. As I've touched on previously before, it's not difficult to figure out some of the sort of basic things that people want. We can make statements to the effect of people want access to their data, organizations want access to sets of information and data about citizens and service users. All of these things are relatively straightforward and easy for us to be able to figure out. That the issue is not so much what we're doing and the direction we're traveling, it's the prioritization about what steps do we take to get us to that place, because there is almost no area health or care in Scotland that isn't crying out for some form of transformational change, all of which in turn leads back to the same space, which is people need access to the data. And because the data is to a certain extent, I don't want to use negative terminology, think words like locked away, trapped inside. These are sort of negative terms which I don't particularly want to get into, but the reality is, in a technology sense, and to a certain extent as well, and what Martin has touched on in terms of the information governance, it's not easily accessible. So we have to move from a model that we've been very used to and has worked very successfully to this different model. So going back to the question, I am actively involved in a whole series of conversations with a whole raft of different organisations, DHI, etc., in order to be able to work up models of how we're going to do it. I think, as I say, though, the real challenge is about prioritisation. What do we do first? And that's going to be a theme that I'll be returning to again and again over the course of this thing, because there are so many different ways we could address this, but I think we need to do the one which delivers best value to the citizen as fast as possible. And that's not in itself obvious at the moment, but certainly it's something that we're working on.
Shall I know when to come in? Shall I know, shoot? Want you to come in? I can see from my chat box. Just get your microphone up.
Thanks for that. Just looking to build on what Christopher was saying there. So just reflecting on your comments around some of the frustration. So I think the frustration is one of, as Christopher alluded to, supply and demand. You know, simply aren't enough people able to create the supply of these sorts of digital platform technologies to meet the demand. So that there will be an enormous number of health and care organisations, charities, social care, innovation, Scottish businesses, academic institutions looking to contribute. And it's very difficult because historically, the platform components haven't been available to anyone other than the NHS people building them out. And so in terms of prioritization, from our point of view, it's only a platform if other people can use it. So if it's just one team that is, gatekeeping the ability to use these tools, then we're going to forever be throttled by that capacity. If you look at what the NHS across the UK has done, NHSX, etc., they focused on saying, right, first task is make test and sandbox environments of these platform components available to the broader innovation community, let charities and independents and universities and businesses and others come in and learn by doing and self-service, so that not everyone is dependent on the NHS to hold their hand and take them through these processes. That doesn't necessarily mean that the things they do will be switched on in live service, because that's still subject to governance. of course, and subject to strategy, but nonetheless, there's a for me, the highest priority is making sure we activate as much of our innovation community as possible by giving them open access to an open platform. I think that's the thing we were missing prior to the pandemic. And while the vaccine delivery has shown what's possible, it's still only possible for a relatively small group of people inside the body of the NHS to enact. And we need to open that up and give people more access.
And Chris Mackie wanted to come in on this.
Yes, I just wanted to expand a little bit on the role of the third sector, and really just to sort of say that when we, you talk about involving different partners and having conversations, when it comes to the third sector, the inequality as regards to the amount of resource that third sector organisations have is a factor, and it feels to me that the third sector has some way to go to get to where it needs to be to work with the likes of the National Digital Platform. I'd also say don't forget about the independent sector as well. That's an important provider of social care, as you'll already be aware. And finally, just to mention the role of libraries. That's something that's come through from the engagement that we've done. We've done quite a lot of work in working with libraries, and I think they're often forgotten about in terms of the contribution that they make to health and wellbeing, and can do so also in a digital sphere.
Thank you. Sandesh, you wanted to come on to this theme.
Thank you, convener. This is a question for Christopher Roth and perhaps Steve Bagley. With all the digital platform and the cloud sharing and all the wonderful innovations that we are looking to do, does the NHS, that includes primary and secondary care, have the appropriate hardware and the broadband speeds to actually access all of this?
Mostly, I would say, is the answer to that. I think, yes, mostly. One of the key elements of the technology that we're delivering is that the device itself that you consume the information on, the systems are essentially agnostic. So whether we're talking about an iPad or a tablet device, phone, a computer, a laptop, all of these things are able to consume the information and data that we'd be supplying off the platform. That's one of the really exciting things about the new technology. I think in terms of broadband, in terms of the actual connectivity, I think we used to be a curate's egg. We used to be good in parts. I think now we're generally good with bits that aren't so good. And unsurprisingly, a lot of that's to do with the geography and the topology of this fabulous nation. It's, you're trying to get connectivity into the sort of, mountains of the north. It's not easy or straightforward. But I do think also it is worth pointing out that the mass vaccination program, that was delivered in 8,600 different spaces across Scotland over the internet connectivity infrastructure that Scotland has. I think that's pretty impressive. That's 10 million events. That's 4.5 million people that have been affected by that, all of whom were able to access health and care in environments that had never been used before, like Motherwell football ground, who knew that would be a health environment that we needed to deliver into. And yet the technologies we're now building and delivering on are exactly the ones that we can do that as and when we need to. So I don't think that we should be complacent about connectivity. I don't think that it's something that we can just ignore. I think it's something that we need to keep pushing on. I know there's the Scottish Government 100 series. All of these things are going to be incredibly important because connectivity, success of the program is predicated on connectivity. But I think we've come a long way in the last 5 years. I mean, again, it's one of those areas where I'm optimistic that we're heading in the right direction. And we have proven that we've got enough infrastructure to get to the population as in its entirety. To do that on a daily basis, I think we still need to push on even further. But I think we are doing well, but we can always do better.
Thank you. And can I come on to the development of the digital services? The range of digital services that we've seen, particularly during the pandemic, and questions led by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. And I think panellists have already touched on the necessity during COVID to really upscale what we're doing in terms of digital and to move that forward by necessity, I guess. Obviously, NHS 24 has had a key role in developing many of these services, and I think it's fair to say that there has been a degree of kind of very quick moving upscaling within that, perhaps projects that were already planned to move forward. But I suppose I just want to get a sense of perhaps Jim Miller's reflections on what has worked well and what has been challenging. I mean, I think certainly from my own experience, certain applications have worked better than others at various points and have needed refining and testing as we go forward. But I wondered if Jim wanted to perhaps just kick us off with some reflections on that.
Thanks very much for the question. I think the simple answer is the speed of implementation has both benefits and challenges. I think it allows for almost a unique approach, certainly in the early days of the pandemic, where we had collectively as a nation a single aim, and that was to protect ourselves against the pandemic in whichever way we could. So that gave a clarity of thought, which actually then gave a real push and drive and innovation. So that was fairly fertile ground. From an NHS 24 perspective, you're right to say that many of these plans were perhaps part of the strategic ambition, but moving from an organisational level where we were pre-pandemic predominantly an out-of-hours service, where services would not be otherwise available, to truly a 24/7 service, and we have been now for almost 2 years. The benefits of that are manifest, continue to be so as we are still within the pandemic. But I also think that the attitudes, behaviours and expectations of the public have changed, and they accept various ways of accepting and receiving services in indeed NHS 24. And the reason I say that, so for example, where people now have a choice of services in hours, Monday to Friday, 9 till 5, whether that's to access GP services, whether it's to access other primary care, or whether it's to access some digital-based services in NHS 24, we're seeing the numbers both are steady and indeed increasing in terms of accessing those services. So people are making a conscious choice time and time again. So that tells us they've got many things right. Some of the challenges in terms of, I think there's perhaps the there's a demographic here, I think, certainly in that at 25 to 34 year old, where there's an expectation of perhaps an enhanced transactional ability for some of the services that they may be used to in terms of that their broader digital interactions, that we are moving at a slower pace, so they're perhaps disappointed with the lack of ability to interact with those services. You know, it's maybe slightly old-fashioned in consideration for some of the younger people who think that they can do this completely digitally, whereas some of them still require either information governance protocols, or indeed that there's a lack of transactional ability within the service itself that requires further telephony follow-up, or indeed face-to-face follow-up. So I'm not sure that's a bad thing, but I think it almost goes back to the ambitions of the strategy around making sure that it's, everything is people-centric, that people understand what it is we're trying to develop, and we're not pushing solutions on people. I think that the last thing I would reflect on is, I think it's important for all organisations to look at what it's developed at pace over the last 18 months and just check themselves and indeed those services, if those services are now becoming the phrase business as usual, if those services are going to be maintained, then are they going to be fit for purpose for the long term as they were as an expedient? And I think it's incumbent on all organisations like 24 and others across health and care just to review those services. So for example, the service that you build and implement over a weekend may actually be different from that that you would build if you had a period of time. So I think 24 has done remarkably well, and I think the staff have done a fantastic job in running with the required pace. But I also think there's a period of reflection as we hopefully move out of pandemic and become more business as usual for those services. Thank you.
Thank you for that response. I mean, I think your assessment is fair. I think there's a sense that perhaps there were challenges, I think, in terms of trying to get things up and running initially around perhaps proof of vaccination, for example, which obviously took a while to come on stream into a more digital format. You know, I think that's an interesting point you make about perhaps that, can I say, younger cohort. Although I think, to be fair, my sense from my inbox is that that goes across age ranges as well, that people have a real desire, I think, to have things in one place, in one app, perhaps, particularly in terms of the vaccination status. I mean, it's certainly issues around where they can book vaccinations and things like that. And I think COVID has brought all that to the fore. So maybe to bring those themes together, there is an ambition to have that sort of one door, one digital door approach more broadly. And I suppose that's about how we access services as well. So I suppose the question within that is, how do you bring all the parts of that together? And is there an ambition to essentially have something like a one-door app that will allow us to both access our medical records if we require them, but also indeed to use services?
And that's to Jim Miller.
I suppose it might be Jim's bailiwick, yeah.
Happy to pick up. I'm sure others will have a contribution in this space. So I'll speak from an Interest24 perspective, in the sense that I think that you're absolutely right. If I take NHS Inform as an example of what a front door could look like, that's grown both in terms of, I think, its level of public trust, its transactional capabilities, and others, what you can do in that space. And even if we take the start of this year, so fairly heavily into the pandemic, NHS Inform was running around just over 5 million hits a month. Towards the end of this year, and indeed last month, that was up to 8 million hits a month. And part of that is around the content, and particularly, I think, the increased content around COVID and vaccination status. So people are moving towards where they see a coalescence of data and services. So there's definitely a demand there. I think your point about that idea of it, frankly, if we can make it simple, all of the information, all of the services are in one place, or indeed this idea of the front door that you enter and then are offered choices within it, that's been clearly really beneficial. I think 24 has, without sounding like a sales pitch, I do think 24 has a fantastic opportunity to almost act as that front door. And indeed, if I reflect on some of the potential opportunity within the National Care Service, NHS 24 clearly still has more of a health than care focus. That may not always be the case. And indeed, is there an opportunity to expand those services using the technology, the approach, and the acceptance of the public and understanding NHS 24 suite of services as to what that could mean if it was expanded across the health and care environment. So there's definitely more to be done, I think, in that space, and more to be considered. Whether it's through an NHS Inform or an NHS 24111 type service or something else, I think there are lessons can be learned from our experience. But I'm sure other colleagues will want to pick up on that. Thank you.
Yep, we have Shalona Shute wants to come in on this.
Great, thank you very much. So I agree with the successes we've had around some of the COVID elements and the kind of standardisation of access around some of those assets. I guess a point of caution I'll put in there, which is to say that what we're talking about here with the kind of front door chat is what was previously been called a patient portal or a national patient portal. And globally, the kind of literature we've done systematic review around this is not positive on the impact for citizens, the benefits, and the deliverability of that kind of central one-stop shop experience. That tends to be because the health and care experiences are so diverse, with so many localities and groups and conditions and specialities and needs, that it becomes incredibly difficult to create an experience that will meet the needs of such diverse groups and regions and peoples. That said, some things will absolutely land well in that space. Tell us, booking a GP appointment, booking a repeat prescription, accessing a vaccine appointment or record, and these are absolute, these are high volume, very easily standardized things in relative terms that we should be thinking about for that kind of single experience. For example, if you were living with multiple sclerosis and had 10 to 14 different organizations that you interacted with, a dozen different carers and support people, and complex care needs, it's highly unlikely that that single experience is going to cut it. And equally, if you were feeling maybe possibly stigmatized around maybe going in for a sexually transmitted infection experience, for example, you may not want to go through the front door, if that makes sense. There are lots of different experiences that you might need to be somewhere else and create a bit of separation. So just, yes, absolutely, let's create these standard experiences, but let's not push and force everything into one space, because I promise you, you will disenfranchise millions if we do so.
And can I bring in Martin Wallace?
So I think two points. Firstly, I've got the pleasure of being the chair for Digital Identity Scotland programme at Scottish Government as well. And the front door, getting in the front door is the easy part. The hard part we have to do as health and care is getting the rooms in the house in order so the patient and the member of staff can walk through the GP room, the dentistry room, the pharmacy room, the clinical room, being able to get appointments and stuff like this. And what we need to do as the technologist on this panel is to be building the building blocks for those rooms round about the individual whilst we're still delivering services and whilst we're still protecting families, which is a challenge. In local government, we've had a front door for councils for 7-8 years with my account, and 25 councils have been using that. We've done proof of concept for Greater Glasgow and Clyde a few years ago for being able to access a patient record. So the technology is there. The challenge is the building blocks for those rooms and the governance and the ethics and the cybersecurity and the different ways we do things to actually build that capability out, which is a more complex piece. But there's plans in place to actually make that reality. And there's also plans, you know, obviously working with Digital Identity Scotland's board as well, Scottish Government, to actually make that reality too.
Wanted to come in on this. Chris Mackey, bring up his microphone. Thank you.
Yeah, just to echo some of the points that have already been made, I think it's hard to argue with the kind of Once for Scotland approach and to reduce that sort of duplication, and if investment funds are tight, then it doesn't make sense to be doing multiple things. However, you know, I think when we look at communities and when we look at the way that life is, there is a diversity, there is a complexity to the landscape in terms of what the third sector looks like in a particular locality, what the independent sector looks like, and what people want may not be that one front door. There might need to be side doors or a back door to enable people to have access to whatever the services that they need. And as has been said, there are certain things that really, you know, always make sense when you're talking about repeat prescriptions, for example. But when it's a more person-centred, a more people-based service that's required, I just question as to how that's going to operate in practice, and can we make sense of bringing everything together in that way. I think that it makes sense in terms of health, but looking at social care and looking at the wider health and wellbeing picture, can we make sense of all of that complexity and bring it together in a way that makes sense?
Thank you. I mean, I think the points are well made that this can't be a one-size-fits-all, and there's absolutely varying degrees of what we need to look at here. But obviously NHS England operates an app which looks at all the things that were mentioned, I think, by Shalina around appointments for GPs, prescriptions, and indeed your COVID status. So I suppose just to understand what learning we're doing from there and why that's been in place for such a period of time, and we don't have the equivalent here. I don't know if Jim perhaps knows anything around that.
Jim?
Yeah, thank you. Unfortunately, I'm not so close to the development of that. We host another organisation, National Services Scotland, are responsible for the development of it. I do think it's work in progress, and I think you're right that there's an opportunity to add functionality to the app. We should. Clearly, we have a different structure in Scotland than we do in England in terms of relationship with primary care colleagues, which has a level of complexity. I'm not saying that it shouldn't be an ambition. From an NHS 24 perspective, we do have the a capacity, but I also think it could be expanded in terms of the last thing we want from an experiential perspective is circular routings, you know, so that you contact one part and you're foisted to another part and you end up back where you started with. That's a bad journey, a bad experience, regardless of your requirement. So where there's an opportunity to speak to like an organisation like 24 and be immediately directed to another part of health and care, I think that's a really positive opportunity. The redesign of urgent care, which committee members may be aware of, really has improved that ability and has taken pressure off AE attendances. So people will be able to contact 24. If indeed there is a requirement potentially for them to attend A&E, they no longer simply turn up. They through local flow navigation centres, and the point about locality I think is important here. So those are bespoke and understanding of those local services, and they will be given an appointment time. So the end-to-end journey time from speaking to 24 to potentially being triaged, diagnosed and treated at A&E is much, much shorter. And as I say, the flow is balanced between A&E. So if you take that as an example and think, what else could we do with that, particularly in the primary care space, I think there is an opportunity for us to consider how well we could have that as an example of not quite a one-stop shop and not quite taking away responsibility from all the parts of the system, but actually smoothing demand across the system and also signposting where other services are available. So I think there is potential there.
And Shalona wants to come in on this.
Yeah, just a quick one. Well, I'm sure Christopher will probably say similar. The NHS app in England is a good example where they have said here is a single user interface for those common transactions, but the important bit, and the bit that isn't often publicised, is the thing that makes that app work is, as Martin had put it, the walls and the door frame and the rest of the house. So they have an appointment scheduling system, which is separate from the user interfaces, which means that a number of different user experiences can be built by a number of different groups using a common engine, so that the appointment system works in a coherent way, but you don't necessarily have to use the NHS app. So in principle, a charity could help people with appointment booking through their own interface, and might do it in a slightly different way. Imagine again, if you were dealing with people who survive trauma, for example, and you need a more gentle up ramp and a bit of counselling and a bit of support. And as part of that process, you needed booking into an NHS service, for example. You can imagine that experience could be quite different from expecting someone to turn up, download an app and self-serve. So I guess the point is you can have both. The infrastructure, the plumbing that you put in place to make that NHS app work can be reused flexibly by a range of groups and people for a range of experiences, and then you standardize what you can, common standards, common language, maybe ideally common look and feel, common definitions, and so you get a sense of coherence, but at the same time, you know, there's a bit of flexibility there, and there are a number of different interfaces you could use depending on need.
And Christopher Roth wants to come in on this.
Yeah, and again, unsurprisingly, I support everything that's been said, but I also, this is one of the few areas where we need to recognise absolute scale. And in turn, that means prioritisation around the resources available to Scotland. And to massively oversimplify it, in England, if you want an app to do these things, you have 10, 20 times the resources enabled to be able to build that single outcome. In Scotland, if we want that single outcome, we've got 1/10 of 1/20 the available resource, and it's already spread pretty thin about around the outcome. So what we have to do is prioritise. I think in England, they're able to do those kind of like, we can build an app and they're off you go and build an app. In Scotland, we have to slot that into all of the other demands. And I believe we're prioritising correctly, because what we're actually prioritising is exactly as Challen and Martin have just said, what we're prioritising is the back-end architecture that's going to allow us to build out slowly and incrementally, because the back-end architecture is going to give us the data. And when we've got the data, then the app that we will be building and extending out will be even better, because we'll be able to coordinate the data that's required. So we're sort of building the house, but we've only got 1/10 the builders, but while we're looking for the same outcome. So we do need to be aware of that, that it is a relative issue. But that doesn't mean to say that we're not doing it. It's just that I don't think we can get there as fast as we might want to. If we had 10 times the resources available, then I think we would. But I think it's one of those things we just need to bear in mind.
Thank you. And on this particular theme in digital services, Stephanie, you have a couple of questions and then I'll come to Sue Webber.
Yes, I do. Thanks, convener, and thanks for being here today, panel. Really, really a lot of interesting stuff coming out today there, and it reminds me of one of our NHS workers out in Lanarkshire who said it's like building an aeroplane while you're flying it, which I could really relate to. Very interested as well in what Chris Mackey is saying around keeping people at the centre, about choice, about inclusion, about citizens having access, having control, having that ownership, but still having the security there as well. And obviously the pace of things has been pretty mind-blowing, if you like. But, you know, we've got huge demographic changes coming as well. And while, yes, we do need to reflect, how can we make sure that we are still picking up that pace and really, really accelerating that.
And would you like to direct that to anyone in particular to start off?
Possibly Shalona.
Shalona, and if anyone else wants to come in that, use the chat box. Shalona.
Hi there, sorry, can you hear me?
We can. Yes, we can hear you. We can hear you.
Oh. Sorry, it's a bit crackly. Can you repeat the question? Sorry.
Stephanie.
Okay, I was just saying about we've been kind of building the aeroplane while we're flying it, if you like. Can you hear me okay there?
Yeah, I can. Yeah, I got you.
You can. Okay, and Chris Mackey was speaking about keeping people at the centre, about choice, about inclusion, about people having access and control and ownership and security. And we're also looking at, you know, the pace has gone through the roof, but while we can reflect that's something that in reality we actually need to keep picking up going forward with the huge changes in demographics, etc. there. So, you know, how can we actually look at doing that?
Yeah, yeah. A few things there. So from our point of view, I mean, DHI is obviously Scottish Government's Digital Health and Care Innovation Centre, so we grapple with this in everything we do. How do you spend enough time putting fuel in the chainsaw? You know, you got to put down the axe for enough time to do so, if that makes sense. And it's always really, really, really difficult to create that capacity. I guess that's why we keep saying, again, as an innovation centre, for us the highest priority is making sure that we activate the largest possible number of collaborators to work within a common standards framework. We've got a number of Scottish universities, you know, huge groups of clinical, academic, industry, third sector innovators who are queuing up to offer support. The problem is it's difficult to activate them, because if we don't have common infrastructure, if it's not openly available and accessible, there's a chance that each of those groups goes off and plows its own furrow and adds more noise without necessarily kind of helping keep the system together. That's why we're saying, again, this is why I keep reflecting what NHSX have done well, is focus on, as Christopher has described, focus on, here is a national clinical data store. Here are some test environments to be able to work with that data store on a self-service basis, so it doesn't depend on us having staff to help them get there. Here is some guidance, here are some standards, and then basically saying, if you can come and show us working with a charity and a business and you know, a university or whatever it may be, that you can deliver a local service for someone living with, frailty or otherwise. And if you can show us an improved outcome, and you can show that you've done that in accordance with these standards using the common infrastructure, at that point we can talk about activating that, thinking about what that looks like as part of the bigger piece. But it's almost like let's crowdsource some of that bottom up will to change, give them the tools to do it in a standardized way, but kind of, you know, let the flowers bloom. And I think that would be my argument, is that we need to tap into that network, that broader Scottish community, and then have some sort of process whereby we figure out what the acceptance criteria for the things that people build would be, and then what health and care, formal health and care services can then help them onboard into the national infrastructure fully. But at the moment, as I said, we're everyone's queued up at the door, but you know, there's no door handle.
And can I bring in Martin Wallace, who wants to come in on this?
I think it kind of goes back to sort of principles around about how do we help individuals in Scotland understand health and data literacy about what's available to them. And that's from people in the most vulnerable parts of society to kind of the higher class of society who just, you know, de rigueur of using a smartphone every single day for living their lives. And I'd like to put it down to maybe like 3 points, or ACE for short, so the assets. What are the assets available? So we've had Connecting Scotland last year, massive multi-million pound investment, getting devices for vulnerable children, vulnerable families. We've got a device for every child happening with the government's commitment as well in education. What physical assets are there for that individual to go to get learning support? And that could be through third sector or using SCVO's digital essentials, digital literacy piece. From the citizen point of view, go to where the citizen is or the customer is and understand what matters to them. How do we get and support them and help them understand how they can do things digitally and with data, with connectivity as well around about it. And last but not least, the employees, the E of the ACE, to make sure, well, are the employees engaged? Are they getting the right information at the right time to make the right choices with that individual, that citizen that they're actually dealing with on a daily basis? So I think, you know, there's also mechanisms already in place we could use to manipulate that. But we work as, you know, one sector with third sector to make that deliverable happen.
And Steve Bagley wanted to come in.
I think it will be a challenge for some of the smaller organisations, smaller health boards, smaller local authorities to maintain the pace in comparison to the larger organisations. And it's sort of echoing what Christopher was saying a minute ago about England versus Scotland. The same is true of these different organisations in Scotland, because the scale is so different between, say, Glasgow and Shetland, for example. But I do think we need to have a different model for delivery, probably more things supported, at least nationally, with our local, you know, domain knowledge of, you know, what's going on the ground in Lerwick, for example. And at the same time, that will help good things to happen in those places. Because I think the current model, I am concerned that the pace will slow down because the smaller organisations have that relatively limited resource when it comes to change and electronic patient record implementation.
And Chris Mackey wanted to come in on this.
Yes, yeah, so it was really just to build on themes of I mentioned before about human rights, and I think that, you know, what we've seen with the pandemic is a very rapid pace of change, and as has been said, some things maybe if you had considered them over a period of time, you wouldn't have done them in that way. But I think that at times there have been instances where people's human rights have been sort of overlooked in the interest of getting something out there and the interest of getting something done. So I guess it would be to remember that people's rights should be respected, even though we've got some exciting innovations coming through. And I think we can do that through meaningful co-production with disabled people, people living with long-term conditions and unpaid carers, using the Scottish approach to service design, which seeks to achieve that meaningful co-production. And there's a couple of examples that I would mention from the Alliance perspective. One of those is the ALICE platform, which has been around about 11 years now. And that's been a co-produced piece of work that we've done. It's a democratic crowdsourcing of community assets to benefit people's health and wellbeing. Also, the Alliance hosts the Digital Citizen Panel, which seeks to support the work of the Digital Citizen Delivery Board. But what we've been doing with the Citizen Panel is to bring citizens in to the conversation about health and wellbeing and digital health and wellbeing, so that it can better support their independent living. So that's possible to achieve meaningful engagement and meaningful involvement with people, and that would be the main sort of point I would like to make, is that the innovation, great, but you know, let's just check in with people, and to ensure that we are respecting the needs of the whole population.
Sue, you had a very short question, Stephanie, and I'll need to go to Sue and move on.
Yeah, just very, very shortly. There's quite a bit of talk about diversity there, in the variation that we have across the country. And I'm noticing today that the panel, there's not a great deal of diversity as far as the panel goes. And I'm just wondering, is that something that's an issue that needs to be addressed going forward, or have we got that diversity going across the teams and the collaboration and the co-production, just to check that's the case?
I can see Christopher Roth nodding there. Would you like to come in, Christopher?
Oh, I set myself up there, didn't I? I'm not surprised. Okay, the lack of diversity is to a certain extent a reflection of the traditional development and career path for people who work in and around technology. I think that's what you're seeing here. In the context of this is a technology session, and traditionally in the United Kingdom it has been a kind of profession where individuals like me have come through. I would say working in the NHS in Scotland, the diversity is enormous. The leadership is very diverse, and I'm also very pleased to say that the technology diversity is now entirely changed. The individuals that I'm privileged enough to lead in my group have a significant degree of diversity, and I'm very pleased to be able to articulate that, absolutely. I think also the other thing to say is that this is a slightly of a bland thing to say, but also it's not just new technology that's going to change everything, it's actually the application of new methodologies, well, relatively new methodologies, public sector, and that is the agile. And the only reason I would mention that is to go back to the point about the only way that you're ever going to build systems that people are actually going to use effectively in the way that you want them is to build it with the people who are going to use them. And that's what agile methodology does. And that's what we at NHS Education for Scotland and across all of the other groups that I'm working with apply as the methodology for the development. So we target the individuals who are going to use the software and ask them how it's going to work. And that comes back to a point that's been made previously before, which is that there is no one way of doing it. We must not make the mistake of thinking that because it makes common sense to us that you'd want a single front door, you want everything on one app, that that's actually how people want to interact with their information and their services. We don't actually know that, and we must not go down the route of assuming it. We must ensure that our developmental processes, methodologies, outcomes are all focused around saying, actually, we know what the outcome is, and we know what the data is we can bring to bear. We've got those two ends, we've got the start point and the end point, but the bit in between, which actually builds the software, that's the bit where we have to engage with the audience that's going to use it. And when you are talking about Scotland, that is an enormously diverse group of people. But we know that, and we understand that. And I was very reassured to hear that explicit point was made earlier on. I think Chow made that point, that we understand that we can't assume that we know what it is that people want to do and how they want to do it. And that, in turn, is driven by the human rights approach that this has to be citizen-centric. And we have the methodologies for that, as well as the technologies. What we need is some more time. That's what we're doing. We're getting on with it. But, yeah, there is diversity. I hope that made sense.
And of course, we need to remember that there are still a significant amount of people who are digitally excluded as well. I'm looking to my chat box, and Shalinar wanted to come in on this.
Yeah, it was just a quick one to say, it's whilst it would be tempting to try and invest more time and effort in making technologists more diverse, I think what we're seeing in parallel is, and I hope this continues, we're starting to see that technology is being seen less and less of a thing that the IT department does. It's more and more of a thing that everyone does. I think what you'll probably see over the next decade or so is that more people from caring citizen, clinical, broader managerial and broader workforce will start becoming part of the digital team, as it were. I hope we can even maybe stop talking about digital health and care. It'll just be health and care. Hopefully, if that trend continues, that will help with the diversity as well, because then everyone will be part of the digital leadership.
And Chris Mackey, before I move on to Sue Webber's question.
Yeah, it was just around the diversity and saying that the Health and Social Care Alliance has 3,000 diverse members across the third sector, disabled people, people living with long-term conditions and unpaid carers. So, our DNA is equalities and human rights, and we actively reach out to seldom heard groups trying to hear those voices. One of the things I'd highlight is our Discover Digital programme, which is raising awareness around digital tools that promote health and wellbeing. And we've actually given some grants out to community organisations working with seldom heard groups, hear from them about their experiences and their views on use of digital tools in health and wellbeing.
And Steve Bagley.
The diversity of the next generation of clinicians coming through. Traditionally, it has been lots of doctors like me working in healthcare IT, but we've got the fantastic digital NMAP program, leadership program. It's been going for a number of years now, and there's some fantastic people coming through that program, which are already contributing to the debate and direction and where we're going across Scotland.
Thank you. Sue, you've got a question.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I suppose, and I think this might be most appropriate for Steve Bagley, but if it's not, others can contribute. Right now, we're seeing a significant issue with delayed discharge, and a lot of that's down to care at home capacity not being there. And we're also seeing people now what we're calling to that interim discharge element. So how could and should home and remote health monitoring technologies be further developed? And can you see that perhaps helping short-term, major-term, long-term on that crisis that we have in that process and flow?
Yeah, so I think what you're talking about here is maybe the sort of acute care at home model, where people are discharged from hospital but supported in the community for longer. I think there's definitely a trend, and there's various examples of that happening in sort of business as usual across the country. I think, though, the current crisis, as I see it, and the data I was looking at yesterday, locally at least, is beds in care homes and staff in working in the home care sector to be there to support people who are discharged from hospital, rather than the continuation of acute care to get them out of hospital. It's places people to go and be supported in their communities. And that, I think that links in with the whole debate around social care, staffing, and so on. That's not to say there's not a role of technology to help this. The even basic information, such as social care team knowing that the individual's in hospital or not, could help improve efficiency in many ways, for example, and allow resources to be diverted. And there's lots of other ways that social care teams and health services can be better connected to manage that interface, and indeed we have a whole program nationally of digital enabled care homes, which is helping to an extent. I think you can't get away from the workforce limitations that we have in this area, which are, I think, behind a lot of the challenges we're seeing at the moment.
And Martin Wallace wanted to come in on this.
I think that I'm actually going to back to almost to one of the other committee members' questions earlier on about investment in health for data or hardware and connectivity. And senior responsible officer, my other role was senior responsible officer for the analog to digital switch off of telecare in Scotland, or switch over of telecare in Scotland, when we'll see in September 2023, the UK phone carriers will stop initiating analog services on traditional exchanges. And then in 2025, we'll have a switch off of traditional telephone lines in the home. Now, we have 180,000 people using telecare alarm receiving kit at the moment. We have been working with Technology Enabled Care, with COSLA, with DHI, roundabout what does that challenge bring us, but also what opportunity does it provide as well? And I think, you know, we have to look at investment in these areas for the hardware, because there is an increase in cost. There is an increase in, you know, challenge we have to round about cybersecurity. We've done mitigation round about this in significant ways over the last 3 years as part of our programme. But, you know, to be able to discharge somebody from hospital into community, we need to, again, still have that interoperability that NES and others like ourselves are trying to build, so data actually flows with open data standards. We've worked with technology-enabled care for data standards for telecare services, and there's an opportunity to put that platform in care homes. So we're using one platform, one cybersecurity model, one data standard model as well, to really help with the flow, so people can live independently but still have that peace of mind and security at home, or from social care services, if anything was untoward was going to happen to them as well. But again, that requires investment, but also us helping to try and build those building blocks and data and intelligence to get those outcomes that we want to get.
Shaliner?
Yeah, just quickly, and I'm sure Martin, you would say as part of that model, one platform, possibly many products. So that idea of having that, you know, again, we'll keep coming back to this, that cohesive, you know, plumbing that allows a number of things to cooperate and work well together. I guess the point I was going to come to was as part of the original question around mobile and remote monitoring. There's obviously a large long-term condition management component to this. People living with COPD, hypertension, diabetes, etc. And again, sorry to sound like a stark record here, there are many digital tools and products that have been demonstrated to create impact here. We've seen work around COPD in Glasgow significantly reducing admissions to hospital and occupied bed days for people with COPD, and that's done through co-management with them and ongoing dialogue-based remote care. There are many products that can do this. The difficult thing is how those products integrate, how they form part of the system, how they speak to each other. So it comes back down to that infrastructure. And so I guess if we're trying to help the NHS in particular remobilise, obviously Martin's answered a degree on the social care piece, but the NHS side, if we're trying to help remobilise and reduce waiting lists and the other things, again, come back to the point that there are many solutions, many products, many digital service offerings, many collaborative partners across industry, academia, third sector, that are already working on this, are already trying to deploy it. We just need to give them more connective tissue, more plumbing to help them do it at scale and do it in a consistent way. So again, you know, all roads lead to Rome, unfortunately.
Thank you. We've given the sort of the digital service a bit of a good airing, but before we move on to talking about local delivery and the ones for Scotland part of our conversation, Emma Harper, I just want to go back to a couple of our panellists, Martin Wallace and Dr. Bagley, wanted to come in and talk about the connectivity issue that Sandesh Gohani raised. If I can come to Steve Bagley, first of all, just to pick up on that, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, so just a quick point. So I think the question was around, do we have the sort of network capability at the moment for do all the things we want to do? I'd say broadly the answer is yes. There's a big network reinforcement project going on in preparation for GPIT reprovisioning, making sure all GP practices out in rural areas have a strong connection to the cloud centre. There's always room for optimization, and we'll always be doing more and more with our healthcare IT systems. So a constant requirement for optimization. But broadly, at the moment, things seem to be okay.
And Martin Wallace had a comment on this.
Yeah, so I think I possibly just answered it in my last answer there about connectivity. You know, we've got a significant challenge with analog services being switched off, 2023 being the first milestone, 2025. We need to work together. We took a paper for a national business case for digital telecare to the Digital Citizen Board last week, which was signed off, and we're about to publish that and start to work up what else needs to be done and how we attract investment to make that a reality. But coming from industry, from telecoms industry for a number of years as well, I only know too well the challenges that Scotland have for connectivity. But of course, Scottish Government got the R100 programme to help fill with those infill things. I think we're generally there. We're looking at alternative technologies for connectivity as well, such as 5G, satellite, infill, Internet of Things technologies as well. So there's a whole range of different things we can do to try and fill those gaps, but we should never ever stop progressing things forward just because a certain area doesn't have it yet. We just have to push ahead and then work with our 100 programme and others to make sure we've got that investment and connectivity is required.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks. A number of you have mentioned already about the Ones for Scotland approach, and it seems like it fits in some areas, whereas we need a tailored approach in other areas. So I'm interested, it might be a specific question about the Datex Cloud IQ system, for instance, which is a cloud-based reporting mechanism to look at recording adverse events and safety and quality assurance and improvement of care. Is that something that would be a Ones for Scotland approach, whereas then there's other areas like the ALICE approach where it seems to be directing people to areas of like specific social prescribing, for instance, in their own health board or local authority area?
Shall I now would like to come in on this?
Yeah, great. So that's a prime example. I mean, I don't know a huge amount about the incident reporting side of things, but I would assume from a Health and Care Scotland point of view, having a standardised single way of reporting those things so that there's some quality assurance around that is a priority. Whereas ALICE is a great example of an infrastructure that's designed to support a variety of actors and people. But when we talk about Ones for Scotland, I think sometimes we possibly overuse it to mean everything. I think our mantra is Ones for Scotland infrastructure and then diverse experiences. So you separate out in your head the things we do as plumbing, that should be done once, and the things we do for people's actual experiences, that should be proportionate and personalised as much as possible and localised where necessary.
And Steve Bagley wanted to come in.
Yeah, I think going back to something Christopher said back at the beginning, I think Ones for Scotland works very well at the moment when there's a greenfield site. We need to do something that doesn't exist anywhere. We can scale it and roll it out and then build on that and possibly extend into areas where the solutions already exist in locations which perhaps are suboptimal. I think when it comes to doing things Ones for Scotland which already exist in places on the ground, that's a lot more challenging, and I think that's the area we need to perhaps get into, where we're duplicating our results stores and document stores and all that sort of thing around the country at the moment, which creates waste in terms of duplication and challenges of access and so on. I think that's the area we need to get into next, and doing that in a Ones for Scotland basis is certainly possible. Needs to be right there on the delivery plan for implementation of this strategy.
And Chris Mackey wanted to come in.
Yeah, it was just to say that in terms of the ALICE programme, I think what it seeks to achieve is to try and bring together the diversity of communities and the different supports and different resources that are out there. What I would say is that these kind of things, ALICE in particular, requires investment and in order to keep pace with technological advances and the way in which the population is evolving in terms of demographics and in terms of need. We just put in an application to the UKRI for funding to really step up what ALICE is all about. But I think moving away from the specifics of ALICE, I would say that there's an order of magnitude difference in terms of the resources that the third sector is dealing with respective to the statutory sector. It's almost the same again as we've spoken about in terms of the difference between what resources England have to what Scotland has. I think you're stepping down a level really when it comes to resource, when it comes to certainly digital services. And the numbers that the third sector are able to play with, so it's not a level playing field.
Emma,
thanks, Convener. Just a quick sup. I'm interested to know, about Scottish Government policy versus then local delivery. Are there any barriers with either health boards or IGBs or local authorities or even the third sector for that might hinder the successful implementation of the Scottish Government's programmes? And I'm also thinking about the issues of people whose English is not their first language. How is the digital capability keeping up to support those folks as well?
I will take volunteers as who wants to come in first, Emma, or you particularly want to address that to anyone to start off with? We'll maybe go to
maybe Chris Mackey.
Chris Mackey.
Sorry, can you repeat the question, please? It just broke up for a second.
OK, so I'm thinking about the way that there's sometimes a disconnect between what Scottish Government wants to proceed with and then local delivery. So I'm interested to know whether there are barriers either from local authorities, health boards, or third sector or IGBs. You know, we know that there are people that are early adopters and then there's folk that aren't. So is there any disconnect that hinders like successful implementation of what Scottish Government wants to take forward?
Chris?
Yes, I think there is a diversity in terms of the success of the integration agenda, for example. So the involvement of, for example, the third sector within IGBs is many and varied. And so if there are agendas coming at a national level, how those get implemented is very much dependent upon some of the politics around the integration process, how well involved the third sector is, how well the public are involved in IJBs. I think these are, you know, can be barriers, but equally when it comes to different IJBs, that, you know, they should be encouraged to come up with local solutions, presumably within a framework that's set nationally, but obviously what works in Highland will not be the same that works in Glasgow. What I would say is that through our engagement, we have heard a real range of different experiences when it comes to digital, and that for example, the use of Near Me has been a great success in many cases. I would say that the experiences of citizens are that it's not always offered, it's not always, you know, that some professionals really like it and are able to use it and others aren't. So there is a workforce issue there about the staff, the clinicians, skills and confidence in using, for example, Near Me, but whatever digital tool it is that's required.
And Martin Wallace wanted to come in this, Emma.
A question about the challenges for community-based outcomes from that piece, and it comes back down to national common data standards and principles to be able to link the data. Comes back to information governance, kind of differentials between 32 councils, 14 health boards, 4 special boards, and third sector. So there has to be something done. You know, there's central policy, absolutely, but we need to look at, well, how do we actually ease that process in an ethical and secure way to get the data we need to actually join stuff up to deliver those community outcomes. So hopefully maybe that helps answer that question. Oh, the second part of that, sorry, was to say that we have in the digital office worked with the data professionals in the Driven by Data squad, our community rather, to build up a principles and data document, which is in development at this moment to try and tackle some of these challenges. But it does need to require strategic thinking across the whole of public sector to be able to everybody joins up and links up to that as a national data standard, or otherwise we just won't get anywhere.
Thank you. And Dr. Bagley wanted to come in.
Yeah, I think there's multiple factors behind the risk of sort of disconnect between government's policy or ambition and local delivery. I think one of them is the executive leads for digital in the health boards need to be brought into the strategy and have the tools and capabilities to be able to implement them locally. There's a very significant difference sometimes between in the contracts arranged between different health boards and some of our major suppliers, which can have significant impacts on what's possible to be done at that health board level. There can, of course, be specific local pressures that mean that an organisation has to do a certain thing first before it does what the government is recommending it has to do in strategy. And then the point I made before is around the resourcing, which is allocated in such a way that some of the smaller health boards are at a disadvantage when it comes to being able to deliver on the ground at scale.
Thank you. And to round things off, you'd be pleased to hear, thank you for your patience. We're probably a little bit over time, but we do want to talk about public engagement and pick up on some of the things that you've said. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. This question is to Chris Mackey. There are still obviously some groups that are digitally excluded, whether this is older people, those in poverty, ethnic minorities and others. How can we reach them?
And that was directed to Chris Mackey.
Yes.
Chris.
Yeah, well, I think that there's some work that we've done at the Health and Social Care Alliance already that we brought people in to for example, the Digital Citizen Panel. And I think that it's important to look at the people that are there, but also the people that are not there, and some will engage, but with an organisation like ourselves, but others will not come forward. And I think it's about going to where people are and talking to the organisations that are right at the coalface of those groups that are seldom heard, whether you're talking about the refugee community or you're talking about Gypsy traveller communities, or any number of different groups that are traditionally underrepresented. And I think that to some extent it's about the approaches that we take as a national third sector intermediary, but it's also about how we engage with our members who are on the ground within the third sector and in communities, and not forgetting that exclusion that does exist for whether it's to do with English not being a first language, could be due to the devices that they don't have, the connectivity that they don't have. But I suppose I would come back to an element of choice that's thought to be factored in, and that people can choose not to engage in a digital way. As long as that's an informed choice, as long as that's a choice that they're actively making with full knowledge of the implications of that. But I think that there's definitely a lot of work to do around engaging with different communities to address the digital exclusion, which definitely exists.
And Shalyn, I want to come in.
Yeah, it's just I'll put a couple of things. One, to very much agree with what Chris just said. So DHI as an innovation centre does a lot of co-design with the People Scotland citizens, professionals, etc. We listen to kind of academic insight on this, and there's something called the dominant discourse, which is effectively saying that the people in power set the tone and pick the place. So there's nothing we can do to bring citizens into boards and organisational structures that won't disenfranchise them or turn them into professional patients, if that makes sense. So very much agree with Chris. We have to go to them. We have to go into their normal communities and go where they feel comfortable and engage on their terms, which means changing our language, asking more questions, listening more. So that's one piece. I guess the second piece is just a kind of success story. But on that point, as part of the contact tracing service delivery, we developed the ability for citizens to contact trace themselves. Part of that work involved us working with the University of Glasgow and with the Alliance, and the Alliance helped us reach out into some of these communities that would otherwise be excluded. And we found that we were able to design tools in such a way that actually, for many groups, they preferred the idea of contact tracing themselves digitally rather than taking a phone call from a stranger, for a variety of reasons. In many cases, people didn't feel that they would be able to pick up the phone for a variety of reasons. So through those kind of methods, we got a very, very high uptake for people engaging with the contact tracing system, where otherwise it may have left them behind.
Evelyn, if you want to come back in, you've got time for one more question. Otherwise, I could wrap things up. Do you want to come back in?
Yes, please. Just one last question. Obviously, there has been huge public interest in the COVID dashboard. You know, the public have been very engaged with data. How can the Scottish Government build on this engagement? How can we get the public interested and understanding of the use and the value of health and social care data? And Jim Miller, please.
Thank you. I think absolutely that's a great question. I hope that actually in some respects that's happening naturally as opposed to systematically. Where there's been interest in COVID-specific data, I think it has also re-energised the appetite for the public around control of their own personal data. But of course, also I think they've become much more interested generally in terms of what data and indeed what information and dashboards are available. I think in health and care, there's more to be done in terms of the transparency and the fact that the session this morning, I believe Scott Heald was talking about, you know, trying to move away from perhaps some of the less transactional pieces, so Excel and PDF presentations of data, to more truly interactive dashboards. And I think there is more to be done on that with health boards like my own and indeed across health and care. However, I think there's also a little bit of a journey here to make sure that we encourage and foster that interest at citizen level. And maybe don't jump too quickly away from PDF and other forms. I see that as a non-technologist, because I think there's a place for this as well. If I pick up the earlier question, just in relation to ease, for example, ease of providing translated information, rather than wait for a potentially elegant solution that may take some time, then information within NHS Inform was translated to over 18 languages at a pace, albeit it was presented in PDF. So there is something about making sure that we do it incrementally, recognising that actually there may be improvements along the way. But I genuinely believe that there's a real strong appetite and interest for the public to be better informed. And I think Chrissy's point around choice and informed choice, I think where there are options available, people understand why those options exist so they can make an informed choice.
And Steve Bagley?
How to get people more interested in data is to allow them to see their data. Right back at the beginning, I think Sandesh asked the question about ethnicity data and how do you do that. I think if we could show people what ethnicity data we hold about them, then it's a great mechanism for people to check it and correct it if required. Same applies for a wealth of other data, which we're starting to be able to provide access to through the tools that colleagues like Christopher and Chal are beginning to, and many others are beginning to provide.
And Martin Wallace.
Improving kind of on a more immediate level, improving the data culture and skills across all the public sector, and getting a balance between providing a menu of what data is available with different dashboards, but also publishing open data with open standards that people can manipulate and play about with themselves in a safe and secure environment for their own kind of benefit, as well as going back to Scott Heald's earlier point in Committee 1 this morning, round about giving, you know, access for the citizen to get access to the data to see what we've got about them, but also to be able to make their own life choices out of it as well. So I think it's maybe a three-pronged attack. And again, potentially working with the Digital Directorate of Scottish Government and Albert King's team of how do we actually make strategically a reality, an option across all the sector. So that it has to be kind of a multi-pronged approach, but I think it could be done.
And Shalina?
Let them see their data, but and thinking more about kind of more personal data at this stage rather than necessarily the big data. We always hear from people that they want to do something with their data. So accessing it is one thing, but being able to do something is a different thing altogether. I think studies in the US showed that the single biggest transaction that people did using their healthcare portals was to access their, as a parent, a new parent, their ultrasound, download it, print it out, put it on social media. So it shows you that a very tangible thing there, which is how can I use my thing, and you know, what's the emotive value of that thing, and you know, to allow me to have good conversations and build relationships. So there's something about giving them means to use it, not just see it.
And just before we wrap up, Christopher, both wanted to come back in on the issue of exclusion.
Yes, thank you. Sorry to take you backwards in time. I just wanted to say that I work at NES, and NES is essentially a workforce orientated organization where we look to support our workforce and development, train them, and et cetera. And I'm a digital person, and I'm aware of the exclusion issues, both in terms of the workforce, but also the wider population as well. And as a digital person, I've had to think about what do digital people do about people who don't use digital, which is quite an interesting place to be. And the conclusion that I've drawn around all of that is that we need to automate and do the things that Steve Bagley said right at the beginning of this, which is we need to get the machines wherever possible to do the machines thing, the thing that machines can do. And that needs to free up the time, because again, what's also been said in the part about exclusion is that we need to go to the people who are excluded. And to do that, we've got to free up the time of the frontline workers who actually interact with and provide the services to our citizens. And the best way to free up that time is to take away all of those low value administrative tasks. We need to look not just at the things that directly affect the services that we provide to people, but we need to look at ways in which we can free up our workforce's time to not only develop better and more focused skills in and around the digital, but also extend that out to being able to then apply that to automate their services in order to be able to spend time with the individual citizen itself, because that's really where we need to go with that. But thank you for allowing me to go back to that point, but I think it was an important one.
That's no problem at all. Thank you very much to all of you for the splendid contribution you've made this morning. It's been very helpful to us. We'll wrap up this session at our next meeting on the 30th of November. The committee will take evidence on sport and physical activity from a panel of stakeholders. But that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.